part on. He went in there anyway, and he cut 14 points off of the Republican lead. And we went in there, and at 1 p.m. on a Friday, in the middle of the workday, we turned out 4,000 to 5,000 people in the middle of Wichita for a rally. And I think what we need to remember is that it was the Midwest that was the source of the progressive movement originally in the United States of America. It was workers in Indiana, in Michigan, in Kansas, that bought into the New Deal, that organized, that unionized their labor, that got a 40-hour work week and a two-day weekend. That came from the Midwest.
Right.
And I believe that it will come from the Midwest again.
When you look at the power of labels, in politics, you understand how powerful a label can be, you know, that's attached to your name or an idea. Do you ever consider taking socialist out of your label? And I offer this as an argument that I saw, where it was an interesting idea where someone said, millennials in this generation haven't been indoctrinated in the same way against socialism as the older generation has. And so then I thought, I was like, I wonder if Alexandria Cortez would say, no, I don't mind not being called a socialist, but these are still my platform ideas. Or do you feel like you should be able to run on the platform and say you are who you are? Which one would you prefer to go with?
Well, I think my strength is that I am honest and I am authentic. And I think that even Republicans like write letters to our campaign saying thank you. And one of the reasons they do that, A, is because getting money out of politics is a bipartisan and postpartisan issue.
Right.
Everybody recognizes that it's a problem. But then B, I think people appreciate that I am...
Okay, well, don't pick up Jack and leave Tim. That wouldn't be good.
I am in order to get you to like me.
Right.
You know, I'm here. This is what it's about. Medicare for all, tuition-free public college, a Green New Deal. That is what I campaigned as. And that I think it's also important to say that this socialist label is something that I think the media cares more about, because I don't knock on a person's door and is like, hey, let me tell you about socialism. Like, that's not how I campaign.
Yeah, that's like Jehovah's Witnesses. That's
right,
like, yeah,
exactly. Yeah, exactly. And I also think that I don't knock on a person's door and say, hey, let me tell you about being a Democrat. No, I don't say that. I speak to people's needs. And, you know, if Fox News and if media want to continue using this word, they're going to use the word. I think by me saying, oh, no, I'm not, this, that, and the other, it just becomes a distraction. We're here to talk about wages. We're here to talk about education. We're here to talk about saving our planet. We're here to talk about a carbon tax. We're here to talk about people paying their fair share. And we're here to talk about saving the country, frankly.
Before I let you go, then that is one of the key things that I want to speak to you about then, is those ideas, I think most people would agree on, especially if they don't know the label that they're attached to, you know? But then the pragmatic side of it comes in, as you said. Mm-hmm. How do you pay for these? You know, you always see people coming in with economic arguments, and they say, look, these numbers don't really add up. You know, in order to get health care for everybody, this is what it would cost. That's going to be troubling. Even if you reverse the Republican tax deal, that's only going to make up 5% of what we need to pay for Medicare for all. Mm-hmm. You know, how do you pay for education for all? How do you pay for all of these ideas?
So this is an excellent question. And in fact, there's a lot of back of the envelope stuff based on our values. So for example, I sat down with a Nobel economist last week. I can't believe I can say that. It's really weird. But one of the things that we saw is, if people pay their fair share, if corporations and the ultra-wealthy, for example, as Warren Buffett likes to say, if he paid as much as his secretary paid, 15%, if he paid a 15% tax rate, if corporations paid, if we reversed the tax bill, but when raised our corporate tax rate to 28%, which is not even as high as it was before, if we do those two things and also close some of those loopholes, that's $2 trillion right there. That's $2 trillion in 10 years. And it's one of the wide estimates is that it's going to take $3 to $4 trillion to transition us to 100% renewable energy economy. So we got $2 trillion from folks paying their fair share, which they were not paying before the Trump tax bill.
Right.
They weren't paying that before the Trump tax bill. If we get people to pay their fair Now, if we implement a carbon tax on top of that, so that we can transition and financially incentivize people away from fossil fuels, if we implement a carbon tax, that's an additional amount of a large amount of revenue that we can have. And then the last key, which is extremely, extremely important, is reprioritization. Just last year, we gave the military a $700 billion budget increase, which they didn't even ask for. They're like, we don't want another fighter jet. Like, they're like, don't give us another nuclear bomb. You know? They didn't even ask for it, and we gave it to them. And so a lot of what we need to do is reprioritize what we want to accomplish as a nation. And really what this is about is saying healthcare is important for us enough for us to put first. Education is important enough for us to put first. And that is a decision that requires political and moral courage from both parts of the aisle. Period.
Thank you so much for being on the show. Alexandria, I'll talk to you for 10, everybody. President Trump tweeted just a little while ago that he met with A.G. Sulzberger, the relatively new publisher of the New York Times, at the White House recently, and that they talked about the vast amounts of fake news being put out by the media. Trump says it was a good meeting. I wonder what actually happened in the meeting. Well, now we know. In the past few minutes, A.G. Sulzberger has issued a statement where he explains why he decided to meet with Trump in the first place. He says it was supposed to be off the record, but now that Trump's putting it on the record, here's the response. My main purpose for accepting the meeting was to raise concerns about the president's deeply troubling anti-press rhetoric. I told the president directly that I thought his language about enemies of the people was not just divisive, but increasingly dangerous. I told him that although the phrase fake news is untrue and harmful, I am far more concerned about his labeling journalists the enemy of the people. I warned that this inflammatory language is contributing to a rise in threats against journalists and will lead to violence. The new publisher of the New York Times, A.G. Sulzberger, in a statement about his meeting with President Trump. All of this comes at a time when Trump is keeping his distance from the press corps. He's tweeting a lot, but he hasn't answered a single question from reporters since Wednesday. That's the day you remember this happened.
Did Michael Cohen betray you, Mr. President? Did Michael Cohen betray you, Mr. President? Are you worried about what Michael Cohen is going to say to prosecutors? Are you worried about what is on the other tapes, Mr. President? Why has Vladimir Putin not accepted your invitation?
Those were the key questions asked by CNN's Caitlin Collins. She was acting as the full reporter for all the TV networks. And as you know, the response from the White House was to disinvite her. That means ban her from a gathering later in the day that was open to all press. So that was way back on Wednesday. Ever since then, every time the reporters have been able to shout questions near the president, he hasn't responded. It's really telling that he's avoiding any opportunities or any interactions with the press corps. I think it shows that Caitlin's questions were spot on. These issues about Cohen and about his twisted relationship with Putin, these are big stories, and we're not getting any answers from Trump. Let's talk about it with our panel now. Olivier Knox is here. He's the brand new president of the White House Correspondents Association and the chief Washington correspondent for Sirius.
You are going to put on a shirt eventually, right?
White House correspondent in the New York Times. And S.E. Cup is here, the host of HLM's S.E. Cup Unfiltered. Katie, lucky you. You've got the president talking about your newspaper today. What do you make of the president's decision to make this, you know, private meeting with your boss, the publisher, all of a sudden a public spat?
Well, I mean, I think AG's statement really stands on its own and for itself. I agree as a reporter that the president's words about journalism broadly definitely have weight out in the field when we go cover rallies. The president rallied in my hometown about 6 weeks ago. It's very clear that his rhetoric about enemy of the people is resonating across the country, and he is the president. What he says matters, and as a reporter, you go into the field talking to Republican voters, having to hear that, you know, it's fake news, we're enemies, and it adds a different component to our jobs broadly. The president is entitled to feel however he wants about the coverage about him. Other presidents have done the same. What is different is that this president is coming out and calling us enemies of the people.
Tell me about Wednesday, Olivier, when this incident happened with Caitlin Collins. The news broke right before your radio show started on Sirius XM, but within an hour, you were out with a pretty strong statement condemning the White House's actions. Are you trying to take a harder line when it comes to the White House trying to punish reporters? Are you trying to show solidarity?
Well, remember what the WHCA does, and that is that we advocate on behalf of the men and women who cover the White House. We try to bring Americans news about the president, the presidency, what the government is doing in their name. We want to make sure that when there are television pictures coming from the White House, they're coming from the news media. When there are photos, they come from the news photographers, radio sound by the radio folks. And, of course, to try to get as many opportunities to ask questions of senior officials up to and including the president. That's our core function. In this instance, you're right, it broke right before my radio show. I had my board operator basically muting my microphone in between questions for my first interview as I frantically typed on my laptop. It's important to understand, this wasn't just a defense of CNN. It wasn't just a defense of Caitlin Collins. And I think what you saw
do you want to be in this video?
Unanimity of response across platforms, across
said,
news
do you want
outlets,
to be in this video?
Fox News jumping no, in, other outlets coming out with their
I
own
I don't think you're in it necessarily,
the
although,
that,
on the very
it
edge.
It could be someone else tomorrow. It could be someone else in the next administration.
You might show up
and
as you
that's
walk
what
by.
We like, this kind of unanimity of spirit. It struck at one of our core functions. Again, Caitlin was basically told she could not attend an event that literally every other credentialed reporter on the White House grounds that day could attend. It was important that we draw a line there, and that we explain to people why that wasn't okay.
The Washington Post reported that Trump has wanted to do this before, that he has wanted to block certain reporters from coming to events. The Post names Jim Acosta and April Ryan as two of those reporters. A one-word question for you, Essie. Surprised?
No. Trump has, I think, in business and life, operated as a sort of punitive force. I think he really likes to punish people, to sort of send a message or make examples or look like the strong man, the tough guy. And he's long wanted to punish the press and labeling us fake news, labeling us the enemy of the people. Has actually been very effective. As you know, trust in the media is at an all-time low. So this is having a significant impact. The difference now, I think, is that finally our news institution, our media, our press is sort of uniting around each other. And that is something you and I, Brian, have talked about a number of times that we used to see in past administrations. Jake Tapper calling out President Obama for discrediting Fox News or other organizations calling out the Obama administration for targeting the AP or trying to keep Fox out of the press pool for an interview. There were those moments of solidarity. They had not happened under Trump until the past few weeks, starting with John Roberts of Fox really sort of being pressured to make a statement about Trump's calling CNN and Jim Acosta a real news network. He eventually did release a statement defending CNN. The week following that, you had Hallie Jackson, an NBC news reporter, who was trying to press Sarah Sanders in a press briefing. She wasn't getting answers. Another Hill reporter ceded his time back to her. Those moments of solidarity, including the Caitlin Collins incident, are a really welcome a show of strength and show of force that I think has really taken too long.
Yeah, there have been several episodes, but Olivia, let me be cynical for a second. Are we really going to see this frequently, or were these just one-offs?
Well, most of the time you don't see it at all, because what we're doing is we're having this conversation behind the scenes. The WHCA is meeting with Sarah Sanders and other communications officials to work out our problems behind the scenes. And again, it's not typically this heated. What we often have debates and arguments about how much the press will see on a foreign trip, for example. Can we get the pool, that is to say, the small group of 13 or so outlets that follow the president everywhere, can we make sure that they stay in the motorcade? Can we make sure that they see the president actually meet with, say, British Prime Minister Theresa May? So a lot of the solidarity, a lot of the work is happening behind the scenes. But this was a very public moment. They made a decision to exclude Caitlin Collins of CNN from an event from which literally every other credentialed reporter at the White House that day could attend.
Yeah, and it seems like, if Trump has been wanting this for a long time, the X factor here was Bill Shine. He's new on the job. He's the new comms chief. Maybe he just kind of fell for it, and now he saw the reaction. Hey, real quick, one more story to touch on, Katie. You and Maggie Haberman reported this week about an amazing leak out of the White House. It was this email that showed how Trump was angry when he boarded Air Force One and saw that Melania's TV was tuned to CNN. What happened here? He wants all the TVs tuned to Fox?
He wants all the TVs tuned to Fox. It's now standard operating procedure when the president boards Air Force One that all TVs will be on Fox. When he returns to his hotel suite when traveling, the TVs will be tuned to Fox. I think with the emails, they're a smaller example of this broader issue going on that the president does not want to take in opposing or possibly opposing views. And he's at a phase in his presidency where he does not want to hear anything other than his own messaging or supportive messaging. And the emails are just a small example that illustrate this larger issue.
And Melania Trump won. Her team put out a statement saying she will watch whatever channel she wants.
And she did. She did give that statement to your network.
That's right. That's right. Of all the places she could have issued that statement to, she gave it to CNN.
Thing has changed about the Trump White House is how Trump is approaching the job, which was that last year, in 2017, when he was aware of being in over his head, I think, and every president, to be fair, comes in feeling that way. But
I would too.
He ran not as a technocrat who had a lot of government experience. He was more easily swayed by advisors, more easily put in one direction or another. And now, sometime around the turn of the new year, you could feel, really, him feeling more emboldened, more understanding of what the job was, sort of some level of, I've got this now. And that is what has changed, and that's not small.
Tell me if I'm wrong, but I sometimes get the impression that you're trying to say to viewers and readers, don't be surprised anymore. This is exactly what we would expect from Trump.
Right, which is not to say, I think that people draw the illogical conclusion from that, but what I'm saying is, just accept this and be fine, because that is not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is that constantly being surprised or saying to yourself,
hey, I just created a Wix website for my business. Let me show you how I did it. Let's go to Wix.com. Our business idea is a hotel.
Hi guys, good to see everybody starting to pop in. I'm just checking on the chat room to see everybody's here. So for those of you who have never used this system before, first of all, let me know if you either cannot see or cannot hear me, or both. I have an assistant.
Mom probably put them away somewhere.
He's here for you guys. So what I want you to do is
can you ask her?
Have a quick look at my screen here.
Oh, she went away to.
I want to show you what chat room I'm in so that you can be in the same chat room.
And so you just have to wait.
If you go ahead
home.
And have a look at your Google Hangouts here, you'll see that there is.
They might
a
be like in the linen closet or underneath Tim's.
If you click it,
bed or something.
Get a chat box here. This is the chat room that I'm in. This is the chat room that Richie and Rachel are in, and it's also where my lovely assistant, who is going to help you with your technical issues, is sitting, waiting to basically like run around in circles for you guys. So if you want to add your chat in here, just type in the bottom. You can choose if you want to message everyone, etc. So go ahead and get in the same chat room as us and let me know if you can see or hear me, or neither, or both, and we'll see where you guys are at. So, okay. All right, so I am pretty universally seeing that you guys are seeing and hearing me. Good to go. Okay, so. Go ahead and get started. All right. So people always ask me, as an Etsy shop owner, why would I want you to create yet another Etsy shop? Isn't the market already insanely saturated? Am I completely crazy? So, I promise you I am so not crazy. And here's why. There is room for all of us. I know it can feel like a super crowded market, but guess what? There is totally enough business to go around, I promise you. Even if there are shops with products similar to yours, don't freak out. If every idea had to be 100% truly original, then no one would ever make any money. So I want everyone who is creative, ambitious, and passionate enough to start an Etsy shop to be able to get the strategies that they need to create success. So everyone deserves to live the fulfilled creative life of their dreams, like no bullshit. I just want to give you guys an idea of how very awesome it is to be a full-time seller, for those of you who aren't already. I've invited my good friend Rachel. You may have heard of her. She's a bit of a rising star right now. Her shop is Paperberry Press, and she's here today to talk to you guys about how awesome it is to live life as a full-time seller. For those of you who stick around, Rachel has an awesome free bonus that she's giving away today with this webinar. And because she is the go-to Etsy branding expert, she's created a free guide, and she's going to talk to you about all that good stuff right now. Hi, guys. I am so glad to be here today. And Denny, thank you so much for inviting me. As she said, my name is Rachel Thompson, and I am the owner of Paperberry Press on Etsy. I cannot wait to tell you my Etsy journey and story. So let's just dive right in, right? So, my Etsy journey started back in January of 2013. At the time, I was a teacher, full-time teacher, and I also had a 7-month-old. And my husband and I were just doing great, but there was a part of me and my soul that was just not being fed. I've always been a crafty person. I mean, even as a kid, my mom would walk in my room and there'd just be chaos everywhere, and I'd be cutting out little pieces of paper, creating masterpiece, I so thought, of artwork. And so it was always a part of me, but I wasn't really fueling that part of me. So I knew I needed that self-care for myself, and the Etsy shop was the perfect solution for that back in January 2013. It definitely started out just as a hobby. I was not thinking about it being like this actual like money stream for my family. It just was fueling my soul. So fast forward to 9 months later, and I was basically in the slump of being pretty depressed because I had just spent this whole summer with my son because teachers get the summers off. So I've spent all summer with my son and also creating products for Etsy, and I loved it. It was so good, and it felt so good. And now I had to go back to my full-time job. And I love my job. I absolutely love teaching fourth grade math and science. It was fabulous. But I loved staying home with my babies and getting to really fuel that creative side of me. It was so great. So I knew somehow, I didn't know what it looked like in the future, but I knew somehow I did want it to do that in the future. I just didn't know what it looked like. So at about that same time, my husband and I were trying for a second baby, and I get pregnant. So I definitely know, I'm like, I don't know what this looks like, but I know I want to stay at home with my kids. And so my husband and I made that happen. When the baby was born, of course, I was still running my Etsy shop, and I got to stay at home. I did have to close my shop down for a while. I mean, with a newborn, it only made sense to put my shop on hold for a few months. But the moment that I could, a few months later, I think it was 3 or 4 months, I reopened my shop, and again, that part of me just felt so good that I got to make and create these things. So fast forward a year, and now my daughter, so the youngest at the time, with my 2 kids, is now 1 year old. And something happened. I find out I'm pregnant again. And my husband and I were not planning this baby. We were shocked and we were excited. And I was already staying at home, and so financially speaking, we were on one income. We were going to have 5 mouths to feed now. And I knew that I needed to monetize this thing. I knew that somehow I needed to start taking my little hobby business seriously, and I needed to start really diving into what that looked like. Because at the time, I had just made, you know, sales here and there trickling in, but it was by no means could replace my teacher salary. So August of last year, I did just that. I took my business seriously, and I created what you see now on Etsy. I have made thousands of sales on and off Etsy. I'm paper diary press products are currently being carried in over 30 brick and mortar stores around the U.S. and Canada. And it has been a fabulous ride. But besides monetizing my business, the best part is I get to stay at home with my kids, y'all, and I get to cuddle with them. I literally wake up in the morning, and I throw on some yoga pants, and I just snuggle with my babies. And it is by far the best feeling, because I am a stay-at-home mompreneur. I hate saying I'm a work-at-home mom. I kind of say it's a maker mompreneur. I get to make and create, and without my business side of that aspect too of Etsy, but I get to do it while being a mom. It fits into my schedule perfectly. Here's the kicker though. I had to do a ton of research. I mean, I was scouring the internet for stuff to try to figure out how people were monetizing their shots. Like, how did people really create real avenues for, like, monetary avenue streams for their shop? I had no idea. And so, ironically, Jenny and I had connected a while back, because we both are kind of in the same, like, realm of our craft. And so, she kind of reached out to me and kind of wanted me to beta test her course she created. And I said, absolutely sure. She said she just wanted, like, she just wanted to have somebody that had been successful on Etsy see if what she had created was spot on. So I took it, and I just remember, like, contacting her and going, oh my gosh, like, where were you last year for me? Like, this would have saved me so much time, because it was not the fluff that you find online. It was not just you know, these big, here's what you need to do. It was like the actual resources and tools you need to use and how to use them to monetize your business. It was awesome. Well, as you all know, I was a teacher, and I really wasn't feeding that part of my school as well. And so at about the same time, I was creating a course too. I went a totally different route than Jenny. I was focusing primarily on branding, because as a self-taught graphic designer, I knew that branding was a big part of my success, and so I created this course called Brand Your Biz to Etsy Success, and it's really all about just helping you create a visual brand that's going to help, like, connect with your target audience and monetize your Etsy shop. Because, and I created it for two reasons, simply. One is that when you're first getting started, you don't have a lot of money to spend on your branding. You can either throw some hodgepodge things together, you can either pay a designer a whole bunch of money to create a custom design, or you can just get this cookie cutter, like, template, basically, that multiple shops have that don't really fit what you envision in your mind for your brand, and so plop it on there. And if that's your route, great. But for me, that wasn't what I wanted. The other thing is, I realized that a lot of people did not have design experience. They knew what they wanted, but they didn't know how to create it. And so I created a course. It's a DIY step-by-step system of my design process in a way that is so user-friendly. So about the same time, Jenny and I are creating these courses together. And when I saw what she created, and I thought about my course, I thought, oh my gosh, like, I said, Jenny, your course and my course were, like, made for each other. Like, if we could give this to people, if we could provide this to people when they take their business seriously and want to monetize it, this is like the key to the kingdom. Like, this, I wish we had this when we got started. Like, this would have saved us so much time. And so, the funniest thing I think I told her, this kind of side note, is I was like, Jenny, this would be like if my course was on Match.com, and it would be matched with your course, or, you know, it would, if my course saw your course online, it would tend to swipe left, like, you know, it's just, guys, it is so, these courses were made for each other to be paired. And so when she told me about really launching her course, I said, you know what, somehow my course has to be connected to yours. And so I'm going to give you this little hint. You do not want to leave this webinar right now, because I promise you, you do not want to leave. Stay, keep staying, because there is something in store for you, okay? Like, I know I'm building up some, like, anticipation, but it's worth it. Like, you do not want to leave, because in just a moment, you're going to realize that there is so much value. If you are in this, if you are in this webinar right now live, you are about to be rewarded heavily. So stick around. Now, before I leave, I do want to kind of jump into branding, because I see a lot of misconceptions about branding. And so before I leave, I just want to explain what branding is. There are a lot of different misconceptions out there. And so let me switch my screen. I've created a few slides, and these actually come from lesson one of module one of my course, but it really does describe what branding is. And so stick around. Let me see if I can switch my screen. Hold on one sec. Okay, I think I found it. I hope y'all can see this. So what does branding look like? Because this is probably the biggest misconception I always hear. A lot of people just think branding is your visuals, your graphic design, like your logo and things, and yes, that is part of it. But let's really define what it is here. So I have this scenario here, and the next two slides are going to be a scenario, and they're all going to be related around the same one. You basically have a guy who's approaching a female, and he's saying, I'm single, want to go on a date. Okay, and so as we get through each scenario, we're going to talk about and define in business terms what this guy is doing. So this example is, I'm single, want to go on a date. We refer to this as marketing. So marketing is any time you actually talk about your business. Same scenario, now we're on the phone. It's called telemarketing. So you get the picture, right? It's when you talk about your business, tele being what you're doing on the phone. Okay, this time there's a computer screen, and the guy says, check out my newest blog post, 5 reasons you should go on a date with me. It's called content marketing. Okay, this is my favorite one, guys. I'm single. Want to go on a date? Sounds pretty desperate, right? That's called direct marketing. I think we've all met that person too before. I think we all know somebody in our lives that is like that too, right? New scenario. Now the girl is talking to another female, and she says, he's a great guy, and he's single too. You should go on a date with him.
It's
called public relations. Okay, this time, we're using symbols here. We have this heart with an arrow through it, and we have some silverware. And that's called graphic design. And again, this is the biggest misconception I get, is that people use the term branding with graphic design. Graphic design is used in branding, but they think that those two words mean the same thing. Now, here is the meat and potatoes of what I'm about to show you. Now the girl's approaching the guy. This is the whole point. And she says, I understand you're a great guy and single. Want to go on a date sometime. And that's branding. So branding isn't what you say about your business. It's what others are saying about your business. So let me switch screens one more time. Okay, so again, I cannot stress how much you need to stick around. And thank you guys for letting me tell my story. Again, Etsy is a great platform, and I'll be around for the Q&A later too. So thanks again, Jenny. Thank you. I'm so glad to be here, and to really, Jenny and I both are here to really just make it easier for people than our story. We want to make it an easier road and an easier path to success than we had. We found success, and no matter what that success looks like for you, we want you to be able to get there and on a quicker, let's say, trajectory than we had. So thank you again, and I will see y'all in the Q&A.
Okay, so thank you so much to Rachel for all of that. That was amazing. She's awesome. So I hope you guys think that is just as amazing as I do. I'm super excited that she's here with us today. Before we move on to how you can turn your shop into job quitting material, I just want to give you guys an idea of what my life is like as a full-time seller. So before I started selling on Etsy, I was working a horrible job with a boss from hell. I'm talking like the sort of job you get yelled at for going to your grandmother's funeral. Like, it was a bad job. Around that time, I realized that I had no control over my career. I was going wherever they would pay me, just trying to pay bills and like make ends meet or whatever. And none of that had anything to do with what I wanted out of my career and my life. So a lot of people tell me that this is the same situation that they've been stuck in for years, and that wasn't good enough for me, and it shouldn't be good enough for you. So I created an Etsy shop, and long story short, 9 months later, I walked out of that horrible job and I never looked back. Now I wake up when I want, I spend about half the day fulfilling orders and working with customers who are excited about what I create for them. So I just want to emphasize this for a minute because it's amazing. I work until noon. Like, I make more than a corporate salary working half the time from home when I want to. So I can't believe I wasted so much time in crappy jobs working my butt off for like a third of what I make now. And once I'm done working until noon, I spend the rest of the day blogging, creating new products, or sometimes just hanging out. Like, I've been known to have an afternoon drink with friends or Netflix the day away if I really need that time. So this means I can change my schedule, take vacation at a moment's notice, and for the first time since I was a little kid, I feel completely free. I don't have to ask for time off. I don't have to report to anyone. No one runs my life. I'm definitely not bored with my job, too, which is amazing because I have never been able to say that in my life. So I really hope that that inspires you guys and makes you want to create the awesome shop that I know every single one of you can make. And I also want to say, like, guys, let's be real. If I can do this, you can totally do it. I'm just a random girl who had an idea a couple years ago. And in a minute, I'm going to share with you guys exactly how I did it and how you can turn your Etsy shop into job quitting material. But first, when you signed up for this webinar, I promised to talk to you guys about the one tool that you can use to transform your shop basically overnight. I am obsessed with this tool. You need to have it in your life. And here to talk to you about it is Richie, who co-invented Marmalade, which is like the Etsy SEO, like, gift from above. So, Richie, tell us a bit about Marmalade and what it can do for everyone here.
Hey, well, it's Richie from Marmalade, and spoiler alert, I'm going to tell you about the one thing you can do right now, today, to grow your business. And that thing is use Marmalade. So I'm gonna walk you through some of the different problems and solutions that Marmalade has to offer for your shop. And just to get started, let me tell you, it's not uncommon for us to talk to shops that have doubled, quadrupled, or even grew their business 7 times larger with Marmalade. Now these are life-changing numbers. And you can listen to more of these stories on our podcast, Etsy Jam. So if you want to check that out, you can just look in your podcast app or whatnot, Etsy Jam, or even on our blog, marmalade.com/blog. So you can check that out, but that's not what I'm here to tell you about today. What I'm here to tell you is that before Marmalade, you were flooded with information. Lots of information, a lot of it was kind of useless and you didn't really know what to do with it. And that's okay, because we've improved upon that. With Marmalade, you're able to make good choices in the direction of your shop, And you can be confident that we're only going to give you numbers and things that actually matter. You know, this is what we do. The Marmalade team, this is what we do. We help shops all the time. We talk to them. We help them understand. We look at the data. We crunch the numbers. And we build that into the product. That's what we do, and that's what we care about. So, again, only the stuff you need. With that being said, I want to explain a couple different things about Marmalade and how we can help you out. So, the first thing is, we're talking about Etsy SEO. And what you need to know about that is that the right keywords will make you money, right? And that's what you want because you want to stay in business. And the wrong keywords, though, they're going to leave you wondering what's going on, right? I built it. I built the website. I built the, I already set up my shop. Why aren't people showing up to my shop to buy my listings? Well, it's because you don't have the right keywords, typically. This is a sales funnel. I'll explain real quickly what the sales funnel is. Basically, people are going to come in the top, and these people are interested in buying stuff. So they're going to come to Etsy.com, and they're going to type stuff in search. They're doing searches. But this is where it's really important. It's not the matter of that they're doing searches. It's what they're viewing. Okay. So people come in the search, and then they start viewing stuff. Because they do a search, and they say, oh, okay, yeah, like I like what I'm seeing on this page. These listings look like what I had in mind. So then they start viewing. Well, hopefully your listing is the one that's standing out, so they view it. And then hopefully they read about it, look at your pictures, and maybe learn a little bit more about you, and they say, wow, I love this. This is fantastic. I'm going to favorite it. Okay, so they favorite it, so they can come back later, they can buy it, and then you're happy, and they're happy. So how does Marmalade help you with this? Well, Marmalade helps you with this because we have this great feature called the Marmameter, where we do a lot of the, you know, math and heavy lifting in the background, and basically give you a traffic light score. So we have green, that's good. You know, we measure on three different metrics, and we're going to measure them as green for good, orange for moderate, and red for, you know, it's not so good, you should probably move on for this one. Number one is engagement. Now, engagement is a measure of, are people not searching but actually viewing and favoriting the listings, right? So you put in a keyword, are they being viewed and favorited? Because it doesn't help you any if they just do a search and then they bounce off the page. Because they say, oh, no, that's not what I had in mind. You know, how many times have you searched for something and you're like, really, that's what that means? Right? It's not helpful. You don't need to rank for that. So engagement. And second is competition. It's really important to make sure that you can actually, you know, pick a keyword that you can show up for, because if you're going to show up on page 50, no one's going to find you, right? You need to show up on the first few pages. So if you have millions of listings to compete with, well, that's a ton of competition. That's going to be really hard to figure out what tweaks you need to do in your listing to show up and beat millions. A category page. So this is one we get a lot of questions about. What is the category page? So a great example of a category page is go to Etsy.com and go search for silver. You'll see it. Very broad keyword, and Etsy basically doesn't know what your intention is. So, as a shopper, they want to know that they're showing you what you want so that you stay on their website and actually buy something. So what they do, their solution to this, is they show you some big boxes. So I've used four. But basically, the top of the page, when you do the search, is going to be covered by this, and you have to scroll down to actually see the real listings that are ranked for silver. Because, for the most part, most shoppers, let's say 90% of them, are going to say, oh yeah, okay, I'm going to start going down, you know, one of these paths. Instead, I'm going to go necklaces, or earrings, or rings, or bracelets. All silver, but when I click that, I'm going to get a whole different keyword that the people on the next click are ranking for. So if you're trying to rank for silver, it's kind of a waste, because the people, the shoppers, who are searching for it, they're not seeing the listings down here. They're going down one of these. So that's important too. Well, the next thing that's important is that all listings are not created equal, okay? So you want to look at your competitors, not all listings, right? When you're doing research, you want to understand and drill down and see what are the listings I'm competing against doing, because I want to beat them. You can do this in a friendly way. It doesn't have to be, you know, super cutthroat business kind of, you know, cold way, right? Can be very nice. You're just trying to outdo them in this game. All right. So I have an example here for you. This example is cars, okay? You are car shopping. Well, you have a green truck, a blue, let's call it a sedan, and a red, sport car, right? A little coupe. So, but you want to narrow it down because, you don't want all of those. You probably have something in mind, all right? And if you are trying to price something and compete with something, you're not competing with all of these. The person that's looking for a coupe is not looking for a truck, all right? So you filter it down a little bit. Well, I want the coupe. Okay, so now it's a matter of, well, there's red ones and green ones, okay? Well, let's say I'm not competing with green cars. I'm only competing with red cars. All right, well, there you go. Now we filtered it down. Filters are important. Context is everything. Well, at Marmalade, we help you out with this. When you do a keyword search, yes, you're going to get lots of listings back, but they're not all your competition. They're not all ones you need to be concerned about. So we let you filter on material, right? Because, as you know, the different types of materials that you build your listings out of for your shop, you might say, well, mine is higher quality. Mine is using like really quality materials. These other ones are using cheap materials. So my price is higher, et cetera, et cetera, right? There's lots of differences. Well, your customers know that, right? So you should know that too when you're doing comparisons. Category. Again, maybe you're competing. Maybe you do a search that brings back necklaces, earrings, rings, and bracelets. But you don't make bracelets. You only make necklaces, or you're only interested right now in the necklaces that are showing up for that search. Well, perfect. You can filter out the things that don't matter. And that way you're going to get more and more accurate data, the stuff that is really comparable. All right, so another one. You can filter for your listings. If you only want to see your listings that pop up in the search, you can do that. You can do things like check your rank, even check out your combined metrics and stuff like that. Or you can say, I want to see what the numbers look like if I don't include my listings. Maybe your listings are bringing up the averages. Maybe they're bringing them down. Or you just don't want to see them there because you're focused on what the others are doing right now. Which is great. It's a good way to think through things. And again, you can actually control how many listings come back. So how many are you comparing? You can say, I only want to see what's on the first page. I only want to see how well the listings or what the listings are doing that are on the first page so I can figure that out. Or you can say, I want to see the first 2 pages. Or you can go as far as say, I want to see 12 pages. And that's great for things like brainstorming, because you go real deep. All right. Now we can talk about price. When I talk about price, a lot of people are like, okay, well, I use a spreadsheet for that. I put in my cost of materials. I put in my time, a little markup, and then boom, there's my price. Okay. But do you know what price says about your product? Like what it really says about your product to a shopper? Many people don't understand the power of pricing and what it tells people. But we have a chart, and I'm going to explain a little bit. We don't have the breakdown I'm about to show you on here, but we do have a bar chart, and this bar chart is going to show you how listings are priced, kind of all brought together, combined. And it's going to show you, okay, there's X number of listings that are priced at, let's say, $2. And then maybe there's 30 listings that are priced at $30. And then 10 that are priced at 100. It's going to tell you that kind of thing. But I want to explain to you what pricing actually tells someone about your product. Because remember, customers don't know much about you at this point. If you say a big brand like Apple, you are going to have an impression. Whether or not you're a fan or not, you're going to have an impression of what that is. And it tends to be of higher quality when you say something like Apple. So people associate, if something is expensive and it's an Apple product, they're thinking, oh, it's just a high-quality product. But if they don't know anything about your product, if Apple changed their name and then walked up with a phone and said, hi, this is the new generic phone. It is $50. It's cheaper than anything else you're going to get in a smartphone. What do you think about it? What is your perception of quality? People are going to say, well, it's cheap. Obviously, the price tells me that. And that's how this works with your product, too. They don't know you. You don't have a brand. You're in a handmade marketplace. They're assuming that price tells them what the quality is. So if you've done your filtering and you found your comparable listings in Marmalade, then this is going to be just showing you the information for the comparable listings. say it's in the $30 to $50 range. They're going to assume that $30 to $50, well, any listing in there is going to be pretty average quality. And then high quality is going to be anything above that. When they see a higher price, they're going to think, ooh, you know, this person does a higher quality. Maybe they put higher quality materials in there. Maybe they have more years of experience in doing this. They're more professional. Price is going to tell them that. So you've got your cheap, your average, your high quality. What we find a lot is that the advice to go kind of, you know, in this range for most sellers is a great spot to be. Now, unless you're a shop that, you know, is actually doing the lower quality, which is fine. There's always a place for that, right? And there's no shame in being that. And there's no shame in being the high quality. But, you know, make sure you understand that whatever you're going for as your shop, you need to understand how your price is setting that perception. So for the most shops that actually are shooting for that kind of like mid-high average quality, we find that telling them to go right above average there in that area is going to get them the best results. Shoppers perceive them as a quality seller. You know, it sets the tone for the whole transaction. I'm going to hear from them. I'm going to get a high-quality product. I'm going to get great customer service and all that fun stuff. And a lot of times, when people move from here up to here, and they've been selling the same quality product anyway, they actually find they get a lot more sales over here. That's because when people are going on Etsy, when people are going to buy handmade, they value quality. And so this is actually what they're looking for. Now, the next thing I want to talk about is how side-by-side actually saves you time. So right now, we have a keyword comparison tool, and it lets you compare four keywords side-by-side. Our brains work best when we can compare things side-by-side. You know, so think about it. You know, is this coffee cup, right? I have three coffee cups. If I just show you one, how big is this? Is this big? Is that small, medium, or large? I don't know, because I don't have anything to compare it against. Now, even if I start, obviously I've drawn the same size coffee cup. But this one says large, this one says 20 ounce, and this one says grande. You know, they're all the same size, but if I just show you this, so large, I don't know, how big is large? How big is your large? How many times have you gone somewhere and you have to look for the cup because it says, they sell small, medium, large, but you don't know how large their large is until you see it next to the other ones. Well, keyword comparison makes that easy too, right? Because you see them next to each other and then you can see, okay, this one has, you know, a great Marmometer rating. So it has a Marmometer rating. It also has pricing. So you can say, okay, well, is that expensive? Well, it depends. Is it expensive compared to what? To the other keywords that you're going to look at. So you put in keyword, 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 and you can compare the pricing all across. Now, it's also going to show you the top tags that are going to be returned for that keyword. So you do the search, and it's going to say, okay, these are the most popular tags. And that's a great way to not just get other ideas, but to say, okay, yeah, I'm onto something because those sound like they could fit for my product too. So you're likely in a search where other products are going to be like yours. You're in the right place. You're in the right party for that matter. And then the top listings. So there you can actually peek at the top listings and see what those are. And again, make sure you're in the right place at the right party. Which brings us over to tracking. So tracking is really important too, right? Why do some people always seem to, you know, be able to be right in the right, just in the right place, just the right time? Well, timing is everything. And while I'm not one known for being punctual, I do understand the importance of timing, opportunity, and particular windows. And so we have this tool called keyword tracking that is going to follow up to four keywords that you put in, and it's going to track it over time over a rolling 12-month period. And there are, of course, five different charts. One of them is results. So the results is the measure of competition. You combine that with shops, which it also tracks. So you have how many results with how many different shops competing. Well, if you see these start to take off, well, then you know your competition is starting to take off, right? And again, now you have an idea of, well, let's see if my sales start slipping or something like that. Well, what's changed? Well, I've got a ton of new competitors. So how do I differentiate against them? Price. Maybe you sell something that uses a commodity, like silver or gold, stuff like that. Well, the price of materials do fluctuate. Well, you can see if other listings are starting to adjust to that or not. Right? Again, back to market-based pricing. You have a price, and you know, is it staying relatively flat, or is it taking off like results? Important to note. Views and favorites, again, these are measures of engagement. So let's say your shop is starting to get less views. All right, well, let's take a look at some of these keywords that we think are core to our strategy. What's happening with them? Well, it says they're going up quickly. Well, our views should be going up quickly too. So what's going on? Or if they're going down, then that explains it too. It's like, ooh, better jump into a different keyword. All right, it is easier to ride a wave than to create a wave, right? So when something catches on, that trend is contagious. Wouldn't it be nice to know exactly when that's actually gonna happen? That would be great. Well, we have this another feature called trending tags. And trending tags updates every day and lets you know what tags are winning on Etsy. These are trending on Etsy. So it shows you the top 10, and they're not all gonna be what you want, right? They're not all gonna be relevant to your shop. You're not gonna jump on all of them. That's okay, because our little surfer doesn't catch every single wave, right? But trending tags is like that cool, hip friend that you have that always seems to know what's in, and is always like, hey, that's not in, or, you know, starts using that new catchphrase, and you're like, what does that mean? They're like, oh, you haven't heard it? Well, it's a lot like that, but a lot less annoying. Right, it's just pure knowledge, and knowledge is power. So you'll get to choose whether or not you catch this wave or the next one, and that's trending tags. Which brings us to our close here. All right, I need to do two things. I need to, number one, get Marmalade with Entrepreneur. Trust me when I tell you this, we have designed the Entrepreneur Plan to be by far the most valuable. We are not new to this. We've been doing this for a long time, so we know. Now let me ask you a question about that. Would you spend 73 cents to have more successful Etsy SEO? Of course you would. If you want to be successful, of course you would. Well, Marmalade Entrepreneur is about 73 cents per hour. How would I come up with that? If you spend 5 hours a week at around 4.3 weeks per month, that's about 22 hours per month. Now, enter Marmalade. We have an annual plan where you save more money than doing monthly. And it turns out to be about $16 per month. Well, you combine those two numbers and you end up with 73 cents per hour. You are going to spend more time thinking about it than just investing it. Because I have to tell you, as a small business owner, as a business owner of any size, actually, your time is ultra valuable. It is the most valuable resource that you have. So, you know, it's your move, but, you know, make your choice wisely. Number two, I need you to go and take the shop fitness test. We've created the shop fitness test for Marmalade to give you a baseline of where you're at right now. It's going to ask you some questions about inside your shops and your shop stats. And it's going to grade you on things like how well you're doing on Etsy SEO and how your conversion rate is and some other metrics. It's really important, and it's broken down. So, yes, you can get an A in this and an F in that. People ask all the time, why is that? Well, it's because you're doing really well in this and really bad in this. Same way you can get an A in science and F in math, right? It happens. The important thing is it tells you where your shop is weak and where you can improve and gives you some ideas of how to help. So please do those two things. And with a closing thought, I want to leave you with this. All right. Remember that your competition does not want you to do this. They want you to hang out in the forums. They want you to complain that you're not getting sales or you're not as successful as you want to be, right? Because you are their competition. So instead of taking the nap that they want you to, what I want you to do is go out today and do what no one else is willing to do. Because tomorrow, then you're going to have all the things they can't have because they didn't put in that time and effort. So, again, make sure it's wisely, but that's what I have for you. And I definitely look forward to hearing from you in Marmalade. And when you're in Marmalade and all that, we've got a nice little question mark that lets you send us messages, or you can even email us at success@marmalade.com, and we can help you out with all sorts of fun stuff. Thanks.
Okay, so now let's get to why we're here, and let's talk about the 5 steps you need to take your shop to the next level, aka how to turn your shop into job quitting material. So let's get started with the 5 steps. You're here because you want to create your Etsy empire, but do you know what will do the exact opposite of that? Creating a shop with no identity or direction. If you choose 5 different niches or sell a hodgepodge of products that don't make any sense together, you will always struggle to make money on Etsy. Your shop needs to have a line of products that clearly go together. You don't have to sell the same thing over and over again, but they do all need to have a common theme. So don't forget, your Etsy shop is not about you and all your different hobbies. It's actually about your customer and what they want. If you don't approach it as a business from your customer's perspective, it's never going to support you. So rather than showcasing all the latest crafts you learned how to do, it's time to narrow your focus and get down to business. You need to become known for something. So step number 2 is to turn yourself and your shop into a true brand. You're a passing moment in a customer's day. They aren't going to remember your shop just because they bought something from you once. You need to make your brand a memorable experience. There are a handful of ways to do this, and Rachel's bonus is going to show you exactly what you need to know to make an impact on your customers for the long run. But believe it or not, planning out your brand and making decisions about how it looks and feels to customers is a huge part of getting remembered. All the big companies have totally mastered this. If you look at certain fonts and colors, you immediately think of certain brands. You can do this for your Etsy shop, and it should be at the top of your to-do list. Step 3. Okay, we're powering through here. Step 3 is something I see all the time, and that's beautiful, amazing shops with absolutely horrible keywords and search terms. They've named their product something super cute that doesn't describe what it is at all. It makes for a great-looking shop that just sits completely stagnant, rarely making a sale. The words you use in your titles, tags, and descriptions need to be on point. Not cute, not fun. They need to describe your item exactly as a customer would describe it in a search box. Now, if you don't know how to choose your tags, or you find it really difficult to figure out what people are calling certain items, don't worry. I'm going to offer you guys a special bonus at the end of this webinar that's going to solve this problem for you once and for all. Step 4 is all about looks. It's so important to make sure that your products look amazing. Buyers on Etsy are there because they love a boutique experience, and your items will sell if they look like they belong on display in a unique little shop on a corner alley or something. You can communicate so much to your buyers just by taking a picture. You can communicate an item's scale, size, color, who would use it, whether it can be given as a gift. Really think about what questions your customer might have when they go searching for a product like yours. There are lots of options out there for taking great photos, and don't think for 1 second that you need a big fancy camera that costs thousands of dollars. When I first opened one of my shops, all my photos were taken with a smartphone, and they got me well over 600 sales. Once again, if you're struggling with product photography, I've got lots of goodies coming up at the end of this that will help you get your photos in order. All right. Step number 5, it is time for a marketing funnel. This bad boy is all about automating your sales and exposure so you keep getting ongoing traffic, consistent sales, and new people finding your brand every single day. You do this by finding your customers where they like to hang out online. In many cases, Etsy search is a huge part of this funnel. But don't take social media or online features or blogs or even your own email list for granted here. All these things add up to exposure, and the more places you are online, the more likely you are to get found. Okay, so I just touched on the 5 things that you're going to need to create a shop that's going to help you quit your job. Just to review, those things were number 1, find your niche. Number 2, create a brand. Number three, get your tags and titles in order. Make sure that Etsy SEO is important to you. Number four is make sure your product photography is on point. And number five is get yourself a marketing funnel. And as you can see, after all that, that going the distance on Etsy is a bit more complicated than just throwing up a product and waiting for the money to roll in. Everything you do needs to be pitch perfect, and I have a program that's going to show you how to get your shop off the ground the right way the first time. So I don't know about you, but when I first started, I did not have time to make all those beginner mistakes and take like 10 years to quit my job. I was ready to do it once and do it right. So what if you could hop in a time machine and kind of talk to your future self, so you could, you know, the Etsy mogul version of yourself, and she could tell you exactly how to avoid all of the pitfalls and beginner mistakes. Well, think of this program as your time machine. I want you to get it right the first time. I created this program as if I was talking to myself a year ago so that I could undo all the things I did wrong that held back my income. This is exactly why I'm sharing my new course, Your First 1K on Etsy, with you guys. I want to help Etsy entrepreneurs push their shops to that next level without stressing out over every detail, staying up all night worrying about cash flow, or spending hours and hours on research that only leads to dead ends. So we're going to cover all five steps discussed in this presentation, and I'm going to show you how to complete each one step by step with no guesswork involved. I've made it incredibly simple for you to get your shop exactly where it needs to be. Whether you are just starting out or you've been at this for a while now, this program is exactly what you need to take your Etsy shop to the next level, or just to get started on the right foot. You can know that you're making all the right moves because I'm talking to you as someone who's been there, done the research, and found Etsy success with three separate shops. So I really want to help you guide your shop to success. And that's because I can tell you from experience, the other side is glorious. I love working until noon and being done for the day. I just can't explain how freeing working on Etsy has been for me, and I really want to share that. So I'm going to guide you through my entire five-step process and tailor my knowledge and experiences so you can create the perfect strategy for your specific shop. You can take what I'm showing you and mold it into something amazing that works for you. This program is a 2 to 3 hour course that's going to guide you from start to finish when it comes to setting up shop and making your products look irresistible to buyers. As I said, we're going to go through all five steps, and I'm literally going to handhold you through exactly how to set everything up. So because you guys are here at the live webinar, I'm not just going to offer you the course. I'm also going to offer you a bunch of really...
about her routines, work, family. Work, family.
Because they're going to say it's in my head.
It is just in your head.
I think these dreams are the future. It's an invasion.
If we stay here, we die.
Find the freebies. So I've got three awesome bonuses just for you guys. The first bonus is Rachel's amazing brandy guide, which you will get completely free with this program. It's absolutely amazing. I've seen it. I love it. And you're going to learn how to create a memorable brand that makes sales over and over again. Rachel has really made her brand shine, and she really loves getting into this stuff, and you can really see that in her freebie. It's just an absolute pleasure to do, and it's so much fun. So the second bonus you're going to get absolutely free is a pre-recorded shop critique that I did with a new seller. And it's going to walk you through all the mistakes that new sellers make, so you can just skip that part and just pass go and collect your $200. You do not need to waste your time. The third and final bonus is Richie is offering a 14-day free trial of Marmalade Pro for everyone here today. You can use your trial to ensure your Etsy SEO is on point and sending the right customers to your shop, so you will always have a steady stream of buyers. I can't tell you guys how much I love Marmalade. I use it all the time. I'm probably on it every single day. I really can't express how valuable this tool is, and I'm so glad that Richie came along and invented Marmalade for us. So the offer for the course should be coming up on your screen now. And right now we've got about 5 minutes to answer any questions that anyone has. So I'm gonna pick out a few of the comments, and hopefully I can get to each question and figure out how to get them to show up on the screen for you guys.
Your team needs to get things done. With Monday.com, it's easy, fun, and simple. Just add the workflow that suits you. Whether you're a small team or a big organization, everyone will know who's doing what. Click drag and drop to create your board exactly the way you want it. Mention your teammates in real time, share files, assign people to tasks, stay in control on the go with our mobile apps, and see exactly who's responsible for what. With just a few clicks, you can plan for the future and manage your workflow quickly. Like a Gantt chart, but simple, intuitive, and totally focused on people. Your team is organized, efficient, and on the same page. So go to Monday.com and create your free account today.
Thank you all for coming back. This is going to be a very serious video because I think that it warrants some real good conversation. I don't want any of you to be taken in by propaganda. And Etsy is growing like crazy, and it's going to continue to grow. I get questions all the time about whether Etsy is worth it or not, and I get questions about how much I make, if it's likely that you guys will make that amount, what do you need to do to make that amount. And I've done a few videos on Etsy. But there is the Etsy Quit Your Day Job blog series where you hear about artists that made it big. And you also get to see, you get to see people that try to have videos about make your shop a success in like 30 days or follow these directions I give you in this ebook that you pay for in order to strike it rich on Etsy. And I'm here to tell you that even the top sellers, it's not all rosy numbers, and I'm going to prove that here today. I'm also going to give you what the average seller on Etsy made last year, according to Etsy's numbers. So this is going to be a video that gives you a lot of information. It's not to try to make you lose hope or keep you from opening a shop, because you can make money on Etsy, but I want you to be very realistic about the expectations you place on yourself when opening a shop. And at the end of the video, I will actually tell you the four things that you really need to do in order to have a chance of success on Etsy. And I'm also going to tell you a couple things that you need to do in order to build a repeat customer base. So those are important.
Yeah. I wasn't planning on taking it. So how are the Dodsons? Did he get enough to eat? Did he need to?
No, but I mean, everyone's probably seen him, right?
mean, yeah, I saw somebody shoot up the stairs. What is that?
Sorry?
What is that? Oh, that's the cantaloupe.
Cantaloupe.
having a good time up there. Okay. So does Nathaniel need any food for his flight, or are you just, they're just feeding him everywhere?
I told him he either had to make himself a lunch or take some money.
Okay, that isn't what I asked.
So no, it's not. You, in other words, you do not need to make money.
No. Okay.
You need it? Yeah. You need to do it.
Oh, he knows how to make a sandwich.
What?
He knows how to make a sandwich.
Exactly.
So, do you know what the cooking class menu is tomorrow?
Mm-hmm. Chocolate.
Oh, he's going to hate that.
Yeah, but it's not going to give us dinner.
That's okay. I don't tend to take food to work except to...
No?
I mean, not like lunch. I just bring
lunch.
I just bring ingredients to work and then I make stuff.
Oh.
Like there's
we'll
lots...
say if I take the temple water.
Yeah. It's not permanent. I know what you were thinking. What did you do to it? Because I hadn't cleaned it off yet. Okay. night.
You really should listen to all the facts I'm going to lay.
The workflow that suits you. Whether you're a small team or a big organization, everyone will know who's doing it. Click drag and drop to create your board exactly the way you want. Mention your teammates in real time, share files, assign people to tasks, stay in control on the go with our mobile apps, and see exactly who's responsible for what. With just a few clicks, you can plan for the future and manage your workflow effectively. Like a Gantt chart, but simple, intuitive, and clearly focused on your team is organized.
you shouldn't sell both current items on Etsy at the same time. Okay, so here's an idea. Pretty updated. This item is one of a kind. You made the only one that exists on the entire freaking planet. That's how awesome you are. So you've added this new Etsy item to your shop. You spent all kinds of time coming up with your tags, titles, and descriptions. You took a holy crap load of photos. Then you plastered the little bugger all over social media. And guess what? It sold. Oh crap, that's normally good news. But for a one of a kind seller, that means there's one less item in your shop. Time to make another one of a kind, never before seen item. Fast forward to the future. It's 6 months from now and your shop's kicking ass and taking names. Here's how your day looks. You sell at least 6 items each day. Hell yeah, let's party like it's 1999. Oh wait, actually, you can't party yet. That's because every time you sell something, you have to replace it immediately. Because you can't make any sales with an empty shop. So you make 6 new items. You take 3 to 5 pictures of your 6 items. You list your 6 items on Etsy. You pick tags, titles, and registrations for 6 items. Then you social media the hell out of 6 items. But wait, you still have to pack and ship all the items that sold today. Shit, you're so busy it's rush hour, so you drive to the post office with a massive pile of traffic jams. You started a one-of-a-kind Etsy shop so you can have more time to do the shit you love. And instead, you wind up inflating yourself and forgoing everything you care about. Oh shit, no worries. Pick up Buttercup doesn't need a solution. You can create an Etsy shop that makes crap loads of sales without having to work 80 hours a week. In fact, you can read all about how to sell one of a kind the right way by heading over to my super sarcastic Etsy blog, the link for which should be flashing to you right now. So find it and click it, because clicking stuff is fun. Don't forget to subscribe, because this is YouTube, and I have to make it extra clear that you need to subscribe, even though you can read it just fine. Jenny here. Today I'm going to show you how to use the free version of Marmalade to find your keywords. A lot of people have asked me for this video, and I just want to show you what I did when I first got started on Etsy. I made my first 1,200 sales just by using the free version of Marmalade. So let me show you how I did that. I've created myself a free account here, and I just want to tell you guys, when you first sign in to your account, you'll get some great training videos and some tips and tricks about how to use Etsy. I totally recommend you watch these. They're great free resources, and they're going to help you get a leg up on your competitors. So once you've looked through all these resources, whenever you're working on a product, we're going to use a keyword strategy, just like we would with the paid version of Marmalade. To do this, I have a worksheet that I use, and I just go down the worksheet and fill it out to make sure I have everything I need for each product. What you're going to name your product is something we're going to find using Marmalade. The product category is just the Etsy category that you're selling in. And then the focus keyword is a tag or combination of words that is going to describe your item but still get lots of traffic. Now, how do you do that with the free version of Marmalade? Start by describing your item as simply as you can, because what we're going to do here is see what other people are calling this item and get a feel for what keywords are best for you. Okay, so once you've input your keyword, go ahead and scroll down. You can have a look at matching items, and one of the great things this is going to show you is views per week. So you can actually see who's getting the most views, which tells you a lot, because if you're getting a lot of views, you're probably using fairly decent tags. So what I'll do is I'll have a look at these people's items and compare them. So let's just take the top three. Okay, this person is getting 3,600 views per week, so let's take a look and see how they're describing their item. If you go ahead and have a look, you'll see the first word used in their title is funny mugs. They're also using things like Target mug, mom's mug, wife mug, cute mug, and gift for her, all just in the title. Let's scroll down. You can see that some of these keywords are being repeated in the description as well as in some of the further features down here. But if we have a look at the tags, notice that this person is reusing some of these tags. They've chosen some interesting ones like mom mugs, wife gifts, gift for wife, office coffee cup, gift for boss. These are all very simple tags. They're not hyper descriptive. They're not super long. But they do describe who you would give the mug to, what it's used for, or who would like it. So this tells me quite a bit. You can
can also see here that this mug has quite a few favorites, so I'm betting that the view to favorite conversion rate is quite high here. So it's worth noting, if any of these tags apply to your item, you might want to write one or two of them down on your worksheet here under top tags. I usually like to choose 20 top tags and then mix them up between my different items, since a lot of your items are probably going to be fairly similar. So go ahead and write down a few from your first choice and see what is different that you've maybe never seen before or that would apply to your item. Now, let's have a look at the second top seller. You can see here this person is using the keywords big mug and diner inspired. So let's go ahead and scroll down. They're not using their focus keyword here, which is something you're going to do. And then if we scroll all the way down to the bottom, notice that this person has taken a completely different strategy. They're still using fairly short keywords, and they're describing the mug based on what's on it and shows that it relates to, which is very interesting. So you can see that this person actually has more favorites than the previous person, even though they have fewer views. This tells us that the view to favorite conversion rate is quite high here. So this is a good strategy that this person used. Pick a popular show and use the tags to describe it. And it's also great to see that this person used mostly one-word tags. So that's another great way that you might want to get traffic. Don't focus on being hyper-specific, because fewer people are going to view things that are hyper-specific. Instead, focus on describing your item as best you can, like this person did. Let's take a look at the third person. Okay, so you can see here that we have gift for her, gift for him, new job, confidence boost, exam. These are all keywords that are being used for this mug in the title. And if you scroll down, you can see they did use gift, they use enthusiasm, but they're not really using their focus keyword in their description here. So that's something that you're going to do that this person isn't doing. If you scroll down to the tags, you'll notice this mug has an absurd amount of favorites, like absolutely absurd. So this person is also describing their item really well. So let's talk about what they did. Notice they're also using gift-related tags, work gift, exam gift, gift for him, etc. So this is telling you something about who is giving an item like this and what they're looking for when they search. You can also notice that funny mug is something that was used previously, so that might be something that you would pull for your own. And just notice that, once again, these are not hyper-specific. They're just simple, straightforward tags that get this person traffic and describe this item in a unique and slightly unusual way. So I would advise you to do this with Marmalade. Take a look at your competition, see what they're using, see what their favorite rate is so you can figure out the conversion rate, and then go ahead and just list these top tags in this section here. Now, based on any tags you see repeated, like for example, we saw Funny Mug a couple of times, you may want to choose to use that in your title because it's clearly working for other sellers, and if it describes your item, you may want to call your item Funny Mug and then describe what it is. Now, your keywords need to go at the very beginning of your title, and I'll tell you why. When you have an item like this and you use a longer title like so, Etsy reads your item as whatever you put in the front of your title. So if this person had just described their item as "I like long romantic walks," then they wouldn't be ranking for Funny Mugs. She put Funny Mugs first, so she doesn't end up on the bottom of the pile beneath all the other people who are describing their mugs as Funny Mugs. So this is why you want to put your focus keyword at the very beginning of your title, so that you rank both in Etsy and in Google for this particular tag. That doesn't mean you can't add further description in your title, but putting this focus keyword first really makes a difference. Now let's scroll down. She could have also put her keyword here as well if she wanted to repeat herself, and Google loves repetition, so does Etsy. It really reinforces what you're selling. So if you're doing something like this, go ahead and try and incorporate that focus keyword within the first 160 characters of your description. Then finally, just make sure you use it again somewhere in your tags. It doesn't matter where, it doesn't matter what order your tags are in. Just go ahead and use it wherever you see fit. So now that you've learned a couple tricks about how to use the free version of Marmalade, let's have a look at our worksheet and just finish it off using the tool's free version. So all you have to do now is go ahead and search for your focus keyword that we've chosen, so you can see what
expert on Etsy. Compare those items to your own items and make sure you've chosen an appropriate keyword. You can fill out this by using this section here. When you're using the full version of Marmalade, this is just an extra exercise, so it's up to you whether you want to complete this section. Finally, don't forget to write your focus keyword in the first part of your description. And I've collected a bunch of popular keywords from the paid version of Marmalade, so I know they rank really well, for you guys to pick that tend to go with a lot of different types of products. So feel free to circle any of these if they apply to your item, and make sure that you use variations of them, like gift for girlfriend or something similar if you're describing your item that way. Now, the other thing you can do with the free version of Marmalade is scroll down to tags used, and you can see there are other entries going on here. So you can see what tags people are using, as well as mug here, and you can see how many times it's being used. Finally, don't forget to have a look at the tag cloud. Even though it's smaller than in the paid version, it's still giving you some great suggestions for tags that are being used. In fact, when I first started out with Marmalade, I would write down every single one of these and go ahead and examine them by doing the exercise I just showed you, just so I could see how popular they were and what was coming up when I searched for them. So that's how you use the free version of Marmalade to get yourself all SEO'd out. Go ahead and give it a try, and thanks so much for watching.
Stood proudly for America's trailblazers, and we will continue for the next 75 years. NFIB is the voice of America's trailblazers. The voice of small business.
Mention all of her
you have the same template over and over again, and you want to try different sizes or different text on them, use a program like Wattify to test your photos and see if that makes a difference in sales. Now let's keep looking at some big sellers. Here we've got a planner seller that's making almost 18,000 sales, and once again, the image is larger, the titles are pretty varied, and we've got 180 items here. So it seems clear that there's a pattern in terms of why she's not getting sales versus other people's products. The number one most obvious pattern is number of items. There's nothing that SEO will do to fix a lack of items. A big part of SEO is having enough items to get found on Etsy. When you search planner on Etsy, there are over 500,000 results, so having very few items means you're literally a needle in a haystack. Nobody's going to find 7 items in a pool of 500,000. Now this niche is pretty small, and that means if you create a lot of items, you really dominate on Etsy. A large niche is a million or more, so creating in terms of items means you can get your items on the first page of your search just by the fact that you have lots of items. Since this is a digital storefront, creating lots of items is something that can easily be done, so there's really no reason to have an empty digital shop. So that's our 6-minute makeover for today. Thanks so much to our shop owner for participating, and don't forget to check out the video for any resources or tricks that I mentioned.
Is just a custom logo design away. Any style, any budget. Created by a professional designer just for you. Plus, no fumes. Get your logo on Fiverr.com today. What was going on
image. Wait a minute. You guys know I got a lot of videos.
Yeah.
I'm uploading them all. And with a subscription, you guys can check out my top secret material. And you know, I'm killing it with high quality. See, I'm a sharing kind of guy. So here's my Instagram. It's the Netflix. I look good a lot. Man, I know how hard it is to make people stand up and listen. But with a site like this, you're already there. And create your stunning website today. That's all you got to do. It ain't hard. It ain't no one not me. Stop eating chips.
Lots of it, and as a result, she only adds it.
pick some of these green words and vary them throughout. Make one listing that's not doing well and focus on one of these new high-traffic keywords. So swap out the terms and see if that makes a difference. You should never mess with your high-traffic items because you're doing something right and messing with them will often cause your shop to plummet quickly. So when you're changing tags like this, always make sure don't forget to check below this video. I've got a lot of extra SEO resources that can help you get yourself on your back quickly. And thanks so much for watching this 6-minute video.
You can make walls do amazing things, from inspiring a new champion to helping your community move forward. Find PPG at a store near you.
A lot of people have been talking to me recently about SEO. Once you've done that and you're seeing results and you're seeing traffic on an upward trend and you move that to all your items and you're consistently doing an upward trend, that's when you're trying to stop messing with your traffic. Because any little thing you do to mess with it can compromise your traffic. So I like to let SEO sit for about 6 months usually before I mess with it again. So once I've tested it and I've seen that it's working, I'll implement it everywhere and then just talk about it for a little while. And then I'll do other SEO. So a lot of people don't talk about these other SEO methods, but there are a lot of them. One of them that I talk about all the time, because no one knows that, is adding new items to your shop. So SEO loves shops that are updated frequently. It wants to see that your shop has a lot of action going on because it knows that if it sends a customer to a shop where there's a lot going on, that person who's running the shop is more attentive. They're more likely to see that customer. They're more likely to have more interesting items, more trendy items, and they're more likely to be on their customer's shop. So Etsy really prioritizes shops that are doing well in terms of turnover and also just adding new things. So the other thing I would talk about when it comes to SEO is a marketing funnel as a whole. A lot of times we don't talk about the other things inside of the funnel. So in my funnel, which is what I've been doing, I have a clear path that I want people to follow when they interact with my business. Because I know they're not just going to immediately buy. So what I want them to do is I want them to find my blog. I want them to subscribe to some sort of email list in exchange for some kind of freebie. This is something you can do on your own website. You can do it on Etsy with a mailing list in it. There's all kinds of reasons that you can get people to subscribe to your mailing list. All it takes is a simple Google search to look at some great suggestions that you can do. Then once they're on my email list, they have the ability to stay fresh in their mind by contacting them with new things that are related to that thing that they downloaded. So they download a freebie, I can say, oh, hey, you downloaded this free thing. I have this other free thing over here that's really similar. Can you do that too? And they can say yes. And we can keep moving through free things until we get to the point where they're like, oh my God, this person has given me so much value. Now I really, really like them. And I would feel totally comfortable buying from them. So then when I pitch something that's paid, those people are way more likely to buy it. Now when it comes to Etsy shops, a lot of people do a lot of emails and they're kind of like, 25% off, 10% off, and things like that. But I challenge you to look for Etsy sellers who are doing things a little bit differently. So
here is your discount code for this month on Etsy if you want to buy additional pages to supplement your program. So that's a great example of an Etsy shop that's using that email funnel to drive traffic and sales on consistent basis and continue to have the customers want that. Well, another way you can communicate with your Etsy is just to expand outside of Etsy. So we talked about this Amazon creative market. In the UK, it's not on the high street. There's a lot of different platforms that you can look at that will allow you to expand your presence and just be popping up all over the place online. So wherever a potential customer shops, you're there. Now, there's no reason to open on these platforms at once. I started very slowly. It took me about 6 months to build up to 4 shops in that week after I was already established in my first Etsy shop. So take it slow. Do one at a time. Try it out. And really just try and expand your feelers up into new places. Find new target audiences and see what they respond to. For example, I found that my Not on the High Street audience bought a lot. They bought tons and tons more stuff than my initial Etsy audience did. And I realized that my stuff was better marketed to those people. So I changed a lot of my Etsy offerings to suit that target audience better. So it wound up that there were 2 different things on 2 different platforms that were more targeted towards that audience. And seeing those differences in sales and how those customers responded to me taught me the differences between those platforms. So it can really be a very educational process. And it's one of those things in SEO that when you're just sort of waiting for your tags and titles to do your job, you're kind of sitting there, it's a great thing to do.
We know that small business isn't defined by what's made or sold. It's defined by what drives the business owner. The independence it takes to pursue their dreams. The blaze of trail. For 75 years, NFID has stood proudly as America's trailblazers, and we will continue for the next 75 years. NFID is the voice of America's trailblazers. The voice of small business.
Hi guys, today I have a really fun exercise for you. For those of you that don't know, before I started selling on Etsy, I was actually a really prolific Etsy shopper. I've been on Etsy since about 2007, and I've been shopping like a maniac pretty much since the day I found it. So in honor of Black Friday, I logged into my old crusty Etsy account where I used to buy everything, and I scrolled through to see what I purchased, because looking at your old purchases tells you a lot about the psychology of your buyers, and it gave me a great idea for an exercise that we're going to do together today. So I had a look through all my old purchases, and I went ahead and I picked out a few in particular that I remembered being very fond of the entire experience. And I'm going to pull them up for you today and talk about why we're doing this exercise and how you can do something similar to figure out how to make your items really appeal to buyers. This is one of the first things I ever bought on Etsy. It's from a shop called Foamy Waiter, and it was a koi clown necklace. This little fish is at the end of the chain. And one of the things that drew me to this item initially, not only was the uniqueness of it, but actually the photo had a lot to do with that. This was way back in 2012, so when the photography is at this level, people just can't help but click on your item. I really wanted to pull this item to show you guys, if you make your customers get excited about your items, if they see your photo and they're like, oh my god, that's so cool, I have to have that, then they'll reward you with sales. So think about that when you're looking at your items. Does your photography get you excited? Does it get your customers excited?
because this makes all the difference. I was not shopping for this item. I literally just found it on Etsy and purchased it 2 seconds later. I couldn't wait 1 second longer. And you want customers to feel that way about your item. So make sure your photography brings that sense of wanting to your shop. Now, I picked out this acorn set by Bullseye Beef. I actually bought this for my mother as a birthday gift. And one of the reasons why I loved this particular photo is because you can see the size of the necklace, and it's not going to be a surprise when it arrives based on this cover photo. At the time, this was a fall purchase. This was a very fall feeling photo. You can see they've accessorized it with a frame. They really thought about it. And when you look through the photos, you really get a sense of the detail that's inside each acorn, which also really made me feel like this was a quality item and it was going to be so cool and every single one was going to be individual. That kind of feeling in your product can really make a difference for the types of buyers who are shopping on Etsy. Okay, the Nerd Herder. This is by Rocketbot. I love these. I buy them every year. These are little wallets where you can put all your stuff in it. And one of the things that I think puts Nerd Herder up and above the rest here is that they show you in the photos exactly what you can use the inside for. And it gives you an idea for how you would organize your day and what it would be good for. They also show you how it looks closed, open, and they give you an idea at the end for all the different variations that come with each individual product. And I just think this puts them a level above their competition, and it really makes their customers understand a quite complex item really easily. So make sure you're looking at that when you're putting an item together, especially if it has lots of options. Okay, this was a little fox dress from Knickerbocker that I bought for Halloween about 2 years ago. And I love the cover photo of this item because it shows you exactly how the item fits, and it shows you the detail on it. So instead of just laying this item out flat, which would have given me no idea how it would look on my body versus the model's body, or what it would have appeared like in terms of shortness, length, how long are the sleeves, all those things, this person actually puts their items on a model, which really helps the customer to understand how it's going to fit. Then they put their model in multiple poses. They make it clear the features of the items, like the pockets here. And it also gives you an idea for how short the item is. I wore leggings with this particular item because it was cold and I felt it was slightly too short. So in this situation, I really do think that making sure that it's crystal clear to your customers exactly how something is going to work for them makes a huge difference. Now, this item was particularly expensive, and it was actually the photographs that converted me to buying this item. I normally would not spend this much on a one-off purchase that was an impulse buy, but I did because the photographs convinced me that this item was going to work for me. Okay, this item was a gift I bought from Christina Vitale, and I bought this gift for my mother, and basically this was when the rose gold and copper was really in like crazy. And one of the things that drew me to this item over other items was, number one, its uniqueness, but number two, just the clean, crisp photography. It was crystal clear what this item was from the listing photo. And when you scroll through, she gives you additional detail that allow you to see exactly what's going on with this item. And it really gives you a feel for what this item is going to be like in person. Your customers can't try your items on. They can't touch them. So it really makes a difference when you can give them a feel for exactly what your item is going to be like in real life. Make them have a boutique experience online and they'll purchase with you more frequently. Okay, so what was the point of this exercise? Basically, I want you to take a moment today and look through Etsy. Pick a category that you do not sell in. I'm going to pick jewelry. And what I want you to do is just go ahead and scroll through, pick out maybe 10 items that you're drawn to that you would purchase. I don't want you to look at the price. Just pick out 10 items that you like. You like the photography, you like how they look, you want them. I want you to see these items and think, oh my God, that's so cool, I have to have that. That is the only reason you should click on them. Then I want you to look at these 10 items and ask yourself some simple questions. Number one, what drew you to this item? Was it the photography? Was it the uniqueness? Was it the detail in the photography? And then once you're done with that, I want you to look at the price. We haven't looked at the price up until now, so I want you to look at this item and look at the price, and I want you to think to yourself, would I actually spend this much for this item? And if the answer is yes, then that tells you a lot about pricing items on Etsy and what customers are or are not willing to pay. Then I want you to ask yourself a better question. I want you to ask yourself, have I ever paid this much for an item like this before? And if the answer is yes, even if your previous answer was no, that tells you that people are willing to pay this for something they're excited about, so it will help you price your items in the future. It'll also help you get a feel for what makes people spend more. Why would you spend $100 on this necklace, but you would only spend $8 on this other necklace? What makes the difference for you? You really need to figure out the value add for yourself, because your customers probably feel the same way. Then I also want you to ask yourself, how does this item's photography compare to my photography? Now, we've purposefully chosen a niche that you don't sell in, and that's because I don't want you looking at your competition. A lot of us won't buy from our competition because, hey, we can make it ourselves. So this is why we're choosing a different niche, because you can really step back and be more unbiased this way. So I'm looking at jewelry. I don't sell jewelry. And if I look at these items and think to myself, what draws me to some of these items? What about the photography makes them feel amazing to me? I can apply those answers to my own items, and I can look at my photography and think, oh, well, this isn't good enough. I need to improve this. Or I can think, oh, I need to make these changes so my customers can clearly understand what's going on in my items. Or even, I need to add an end listing photo that shows them more detail at the end so they can pick out exactly the options they need and it can be crystal clear. So that is today's super fun, super short exercise in honor of Black Friday and Cyber Monday. I hope it helps you guys out and it'll give you a great idea for what else is going on Etsy, and how you can really improve your items in 5 minutes or less. So thanks so much for watching. Have a great day.
I was always really interested in technology as a kid. When I got to college, I didn't study computer science because I kind of had this preconceived notion that math genius. That's what I really like about three houses, is that they taught you the actual skills that would be needed in the job market. They approached it from the perspective that you could start really from ground zero and become a professional developer. I got to make cool stuff, but I was also building for a company. I think for a lot of people who work full-time, they're doing something that's not necessarily their passion. It's really hard to look at that and say, well, should I leave and try to do something else in the next year? One of my favorite parts of being a developer is being able to create something that didn't exist before that makes the world better. It's less about this is how you write code and it's more about this is how you think about problems. After studying on Treehouse for about 6 months, I was able to transition from a project manager role into a full-time developer.
I just went on vacation about 3 weeks ago. I closed the shop for vacation and I came back and my orders were kind of lagging. So I tried a few methods to try and get them back up, and today I'm going to talk to you about what actually made a difference. I used this method during a time of the year when retail sales were lagging as well. So a lot of people are saying right now that their sales are low. So this method seems to have helped me break out of that lull as well as boosting after vacation. So let's take a look at what was going on so I can show you what was happening and what happened as a result. So first I'm going to take a look at my stats for immediately after vacation. I came back on the 13th of October, and during this time, that particular week from the 13th to the 20th, I got 13 orders during that time. And as you can see here, if you look at these little green dots, you can see the number of renewed listings I had on the day. And you can also coordinate that with the number of orders I got based on how frequently I was renewing listings. Now, keep in mind that Etsy renews your listing when somebody purchases something. So in this particular day, I got 5 orders, and as you can see, I have 11 renewed listings. What that means is that of those 5 orders, there were multiple items inside of that order. So I would have renewed 2 items myself. On this particular day, somebody bought a pack of items as well, so those renewed too. So let's take a look at the week after. And so now you're seeing that the orders are starting to build. You can see here by rolling over that I'm getting renewed listings more frequently. I also want to draw attention to the number of views that are going on here, because if we go to this week, currently this week isn't over, it's Friday. I was going Sunday to Sunday. So for reference, I have not gotten
quite as many views as I got last week, but I'm getting more orders. So the orders are starting to build. That means my conversion rate is getting higher. So once again, if you roll over, you can see what coincides with purchases, how many listings are renewed, how many listings are added, etc. So let's talk about what I did during this period to cause this buildup. During this particular time, I added some new items to my shop. I added about 10 new items to my shop over the course of 2 weeks. And this will always help with visibility and sales. But a lot of times, new items don't actually get seen for a while. But that doesn't mean that adding new items doesn't keep your shop active in Etsy. And it also gives you more chances to get found in general. So adding new items is always a good idea. If you're struggling with orders, one of the best things you can do is sort of buckle down and just get working on new products. Now, the other thing that I did during this time that was a little unusual is I started renewing my items in an unusual way. I was noticing that the normal way I renew, which is to renew my most viewed item twice a day, was not really doing anything for me anymore. So when you notice that a tactic that was previously working isn't working anymore, that's a sign that it's time to change that tactic. Something's going on that's different, so you need to adapt. What I did was I went to my trusty tool, Etsy on Sale here. I'm signed into this tool, and it allows me to manage sales, change my tags, or auto-renew items. I'm going to go ahead and look at auto-renew, and I'm going to show you what I did. So normally, if you guys have watched my previous video, you'll know that I renew my shop's most viewed item, and the way I set it up is to renew every 12 hours, and I usually do it at peak time. Now, I'm in the UK, but my peak shoppers are usually on Eastern or Pacific Standard Time. So what I do is I customize these times to the times that they tend to be online. A really popular shopping time is around 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time because people are getting antsy at work, maybe they're browsing online, they're looking at social media, and maybe they're doing a little bit of shopping for friends and family. So a lot of times I try and get her right around 3 to 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, or if a lot of your customers are on the East Coast, the same thing stands, 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I specifically choose 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time because I've noticed that that works for me. But it doesn't hurt to schedule a few of these, try it out, see if that works for you over the course of 2 weeks or so. And if it doesn't, you can adjust your time. It's not the end of the world. Then what I do after I've set this up is I go ahead and I tell it to schedule for 1 month straight. So if you notice, I've chosen the 4th, so I'm going to go through and choose the 4th in the following month. So now it's going to schedule for a month straight. And then I'll just adjust the time so I get the most out of my renewals. This particular method where you're renewing twice a day results in $12 of renewal fees charged by Etsy. A lot of people hesitate to renew their items. They don't know why they would renew their items. And the answer is you're not renewing your items to get more sales. You're renewing your items to get more visibility in Etsy. When you renew your items, Etsy views that as a recent item that's added, and it likes to show shops that are relevant and that are keeping their content updated. While renewals may not directly lead to sales, they lead to more visibility, which, if your product is converting correctly, will lead to sales. This is about 2 cups of fancy coffee at Starbucks, and you know what? It costs me less than Etsy promoted listings, which, by the way, aren't boosting my sales at all right now. From that perspective, this is actually a cheaper way to get some visibility for your shop. Now, in my case, I already have this set up, but what I did was I added a new layer. Now, I'm renewing my most viewed item, and I was noticing that that item was getting a lot of views, but the rest of my shop wasn't. Previously, people would look at my most viewed item and then view my shop, but now they're not, so something's changed. So what I did was I went in, I kept this setup identical here, and all I did was I changed to a random item. I want to get my whole shop kind of renewing and up in search higher, so this is a great way to do that because it just picks an item that hasn't been renewed in a while and it renews it. Over the course of a month or so, you wind up with a ton of different items that have been renewed fairly frequently, and it just keeps your shop fresh. So I set this up as well. Now, this ultimately means I'm spending $24 a month in renewal fees, but as I said before, what have we got? 4 cups of fancy coffee at Starbucks, and it's still cheaper than Etsy promoted listings. If you don't want to spend that much money, it's perfectly reasonable to set this up for once a day. Now notice if you do it once a day and you schedule every 24 hours, it's half the price, $6.40. And what you can do is schedule your random item in the afternoon and schedule your most viewed item in the evening so that your shop is getting lots of traction on all the coasts. So that actually cuts it back to half price if that's what you're looking for, and it gives you the
the opportunity to test this out. Now, I recommend you test this for about 4 weeks to see if it's working for your show. So I just want to show you guys my schedule so it's crystal clear what I'm doing here. And basically what you're seeing is several times a day, every day, I've got my most viewed item and then a random item. And then my most viewed item and then a random item and so on and so forth. Depending on what time it's renewing, I've got these staggered quite a bit here. That helps to keep my shop fresh up in search at all times, internationally and in the U.S. Go ahead, check this out, give it a try, see if you like it, see if it works for your shop, and thanks so much for watching. To guess who I am and what I want just by hearing my voice. I want to pay with a glance. If you are also looking to enhance your client's brand experience, you have a date at the Retail and Brand Experience World Conference. It's not only about ways of buying and selling, it's about the new relationship between brands and people, and about transformation rather than smaller. Using all the new ways of technological innovation, capturing investment and talent from around the world, knowledge to the greatest real laboratory of new trends, Barcelona, and projected to consumers throughout the world. It's about how people want to experience everything that's around the buying process. This is the challenge. Retail and Brand Experience World Congress. This is Jenny from Fuzzy and Birch, and I am here to show you how I use Marmalade. So I have some fun little tricks that I use whenever I list something new on Marmalade, and I'm going to go through them. But first, I want to just start by looking at an item as an example. So this is something I just renewed recently. It's just a simple print. It's a digital download. And one of the things I always do whenever I add a new item is I want to make sure that my tags are not identical to similar items. So I obviously have multiple prints in my shop, and I want to make sure that I haven't just copied and pasted all of my tags from one item to another. And there's a specific reason that I'm doing that. And that is because SEO works like this. You can only rank for one keyword. If all of my prints here have the same tags over and over again, then they are all competing with each other for a spot on Etsy search. So it really makes sense to vary up your keywords. And what I do in Marmalade to do this is I find a huge collection of keywords that apply to my prints, and then I add a bunch of custom ones and a bunch of gift related ones. And I've actually created a worksheet that helps me do this. This is available on my blog completely free. I made it based on using Marmalade, actually, and I just print it out and use it whenever I'm adding a new product so that I have record of all the tags that I've used in the past. So all you have to do is basically put down product name, category, and focus keyword, which is the number one keyword that you're trying to rank for. In the case of this particular print, it's going to be one of the first ones. Here you can see that I'm trying to rank for typography art. All these other things are various categories, so typography art is the one that I'm trying to rank for in this case. Now on another print, I might be trying to rank for funny art or kitchen decor or any of these other tags, but it's not my focus keyword. What I will do with this focus keyword is I will then use it in the first sentence of my description. So right now I'm working with this print because I want to redo my tags and titles. So one of the first things that I would do is go up to this description and edit it so that typography art is in that first sentence, so that that word is clearly the focus keyword in the search. Okay, that's how you use a focus keyword. So I will also, if I'm going to use any keywords for title, for example, if I was going to call this a nerd definition print, I could call it typography art nerd definition print in the case of my focus keyword, and I would just write that down here so I have record of it so I don't reuse it for another print. And then I just go to Marmalade and choose 13 to 20 tags that apply to this print. So here's how I do my Marmalade. I start by typing in my focus keyword.
Okay, so when I put in typography art, I can see that the engagement is really low, the competition is really high, and there's low risk for a category page. So this is not an ideal focus keyword. As I said, we're redoing this particular listing, so my initial choice of typography art may have been good, but it's not good anymore. And that's because SEO is tricky, because as you probably noticed, the slang that you use over the course of a year totally changes. So there, it's not a far stretch to think that the sorts of words that are popular both in search and in everyday life also change fairly frequently. And this is why I like to update my tags and titles and descriptions once every 6 months. I'm going to take this core keyword and I'm going to use it to hopefully find a better keyword. So I'm going to scroll down here and I'm going to have a look at items that are doing well here. And what I'm looking for is favorite percentage. I don't really care how many views per week it gets because you can always drive more traffic using social media or your own means. But if something is getting favorited a lot, it clearly matches what that customer base is searching for. So I want to make sure that the favorite percentage is high. I actually know that all of these are doing really well, but it looks like 28% is the best. So I'm going to have a look at this item on Etsy, and I saw another one that was at 28% here. Let's look and see what tags they're using. So I'm going to scroll down. And I see that this person is using digital prints and prints, okay, which very much describes my item as well. Let's have a look at this item. This person is, oh my god, using the exact same thing. That must be important. So I would say that this combination seems to have an effect. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to Marmalade. Let's have a look down here and see what else is being used and how frequently they're being used together. So I like to look at this tag cloud. I love to look at this because it just helps me to kind of see what people's ranks are and how highly people are ranking for certain words. So here's one that was very similar to what we're looking at, principal art. You can see that the favorites per week are way higher than a lot of the other ones here. So it seems like this is the keyword that I'm looking for, something with printable in it. Let's have a look down here. It looks like there's printable art. Let's see, art print, print. I'm seeing digital prints, digital art prints, and all that good stuff. Okay, so let's try printable art instead. Okay, so we can see that the engagement is moderate, the competition is very high, and there's low risk of being on the category page. Now, most people will say to you, do not touch this very high competition. But you know what? Printable art describes what I have, and it's ranking well. I did the research, so I would totally take the risk. And on my worksheet here, I would put printable art as one of my top tags. Then I would look at my competitor. I would see that they did prints and digital prints, and that would be one of my other top tags up here. I'm risky like that. I have seen... The thing with SEO is you kind of have to decide, are you going to play it safe all the time? Because it's very unlikely that you're going to find 13 words that are dead perfect. So this is one that I think is worth not playing it safe for. I'm just going to scroll down and see what else is available to me here. I'm going to go ahead and have a look at the other tags that are used here and take a look, see if any of them apply to mine. And if they do, I want to go ahead and have a look at the favorite percentages. So most of these are pretty good, not horrible. So I don't say any of these are safe to use in my worksheet for my remaining tags. I have to come up with 13 to 20 here because I'm going to mix them up for my different prints. That's why I usually shoot for 20. So let's scroll down and have a look at the tag cloud. This is something else that I would use to kind of figure out what applies to my prints. So a lot of people I see on Etsy, they're like, oh, dude, geometric art is so popular right now. I think I'm going to use that in mine, even though it's only like kind of geometric, or like it's not really, but I sell other things that are geometric, so it's cool to use it. No, it's not. Stop doing that. You need to only pick tags that 125% describe what you are selling, because the people who are searching for your stuff are just going to skip right over yours if it's not what they're looking for. You want to find the people who want to find you. So like, say to them, I'm here for you. I have what you want. Look, here it is, exactly what you're searching for. Don't say to them, look, I have a bunch of stuff in my shop and you need to see
at all, because there's tons, because they're not going to do that. So I will only pick the tag that 100% describe what this particular item is, and then I will go ahead and mess with them and change the order of them. So I will take these top tags, these 20 or so that I'll wind up picking, and I'll mix them up in all different orders on my art prints. So maybe I'll take 3 art prints and I'll use the same tags, and then I'll take the next 3 art prints and I'll use a different set of tags that are the same but in different order, and then maybe there's a few swapped out for just specificity. This really allows you to mix it up on Etsy, and it also means that you're going to be more varied in search engines and when you're shown elsewhere online, like Google, so it's really ideal to do this. Don't just copy and paste everything, because this takes like 5 minutes. It's like one of the easiest things you could possibly do to make your shop sell more, so I really don't see any reason why you wouldn't do it. Okay, the next thing I'll do is I'll take this main word, and I'm going to go ahead and hit this keyword comparison tool. And I'm just going to compare it against the other words that were being used so I can see what orders to swap them out in. Okay, so you can see I picked 4 words here, and I'm just doing the comparison. Interestingly, I've had sellers ask me before, like, why don't you just copy this? And I'm going to answer that right now. So the reason I don't just copy other people's tags is I'm directly competing with them. I chose this person because they were at the top of the list. They were doing really well. This is a top seller who's selling this item probably several times a day frequently, and I'm not ready to compete with this person yet. So I don't want to copy and paste their items because I will be their direct competition. Also, their tags don't all apply to my print. So hugs and kisses, love print, XO art, all this other stuff, XO print, this doesn't apply to me. And I don't really think it's a good idea to ever go ahead and copy stuff directly. I always pick maybe 1 or 2 that I'm seeing, especially when I'm seeing a pattern like this where people are using the exact same thing from the exact same places. That's kind of telling me something. It's saying, oh, hey, this is working for multiple people, so maybe you should get on board and try it. So just look for patterns. Don't take from other people's tags, because it's not going to do you any favors at all. Let's have a look at this and look at my keyword comparison. Okay, so we can see here that there's a lot going on, and interestingly, I would say that these prints in combination probably do very well, but individually they all have things about them that kind of suck. There's high risk for category pages, they all have very high competition, this one has low engagement. This is why we choose lots of keywords. You don't just want to rely on one. We are choosing a focus keyword so that we can say what our item is about. In my case, it's clear that I've chosen printable art. I'm willing to take the risk of the very high competition for the other benefits here that I feel like are good. In this case, I would say pick a lot of tags that work well together. Pick tags that complement each other here that will kind of even out your risk, because like I said, you're never going to find 13 tags that are perfect. You need to decide what risk you're willing to take. Because I'm in a super popular selling category right now, which is prints, I'm going to always have to deal with competition, it looks like, pretty much no matter what I do. So that's how I would go ahead and do it. Now, at this point, I would make a list of my 20 different tags here, and then I would finish completing this worksheet just so I could get an idea of what my competition is doing and how it works. Basically, I want to see what pops up when I search for my focus keyword, which I chose printable art. I wanted to see 5 tags my competitors are using for this item, so I already learned that prints and digital prints are getting used constantly in here. I just want to go ahead and go back to Marmalade, and I would have a look at the main page, and I would go back and I would see what other words my competitors are using, and it seems clear here what's popular for printable art, you know, wall art, instant download printable, etc. So I could list those here for myself so I have an idea of what other people are calling their item and whether that's working or not. Then I would write the first sentence of my description using my focus keyword printable art, and this just helps me get the ball rolling and allows me to just copy and paste right into Etsy. Then what I do is I have this list of popular keywords that I can use for any given item. Sometimes they apply, sometimes they don't. This is something I do for myself, by the way. For my shop, I've chosen these words. They do work for most shops, but keep in mind that you don't have to use this. It's just something that I do. And I did find these words using Marmalade. In fact, let me show you how I found them. I went to this cool little trending page. This shows you the top 10 tags that are trending on Etsy at any given time. Now, not all of these apply to every shop, so I've been doing this for a really long time. I don't know
doing my own research on Etsy with my stuff to find these words. You can see gift for her is here, and gift for her is here, and so on and so forth. They're basically just amalgamated words that work in general for most shops, and I circle these when I'm like, when I don't have 13 tags for something, I will go through and I will find more here just because it's easy. It's also a good idea if you really want to be tricky to go ahead and look at this list frequently if you want product inspiration or you want to be trending with something or you have an item that you think would trend well. So for example, Christmas gift is trending right now. It's about the end of August right now, so this would be a good time to go through and tag all your items that could be a Christmas gift as Christmas gift. It would also be a good time to tag them gift for her because these two things tend to fit into the same category. So that's how I use the trending tags. I'll usually look at it once a month minimum. And it's important to always have one tag that you can just kind of swap out at will. Go ahead, give that a try. Hopefully this helps. And don't forget that marmalade is awesome. And if you want this worksheet, you can download it on my blog, which is blog.fuzzyandbirch.com. Thanks so much for watching.
Projected to consumers throughout the world. It's about how people want to experience everything that's around the buying process. This is the challenge. Retail and Brand Experience World Congress. Challenge accepted.
Hey everyone, this is Dahlia Abdullah, the Handmade Mastermind, and in this video I'm going to show you how I use Marmalade, the entrepreneur plan, for SEO, keywords, and all that good stuff to really help my listings. Okay, I'm really excited to show you this. I'm going to walk it through step by step so you really can understand it. Now, if you're interested in using the entrepreneur plan, I am putting a link down below for you. It'll give you 14 free days to try it out and test it for yourself. Okay, so of course I already have the entrepreneur plan, so I'm going to go ahead and log in. Okay, so after I log in, I want to kind of walk you through some basic things before I go into detail. Right now, it's kind of analyzing my shop listing, so this may take a minute or so. But just so you know, when you do have the entrepreneur plan, even the free plan, you're able to add more shops. So you can hit manage shops and connect another one. So this is what I love about this. So the entrepreneur plan, you can pay monthly for it. And of course, a lot of us have more than one shop, and you don't have to pay monthly for multiple times, right, for multiple shops. You can pay monthly once, right, the $19 a month, and you're able to connect all your shops in here. I currently have two very active shops and one not so active, so I could connect all three of them. Okay, so this would save you a lot of money, obviously, if you want to connect more than one shop, which I absolutely love, okay? Now, if you go back to the listing, this is what you first see when you log in. Obviously, you'll see your own products. This is mine. But you'll get these little grade scores on all your listings. Just for the record, not only will you see a grade, you'll see a color. And you probably can guess, but the green is good. The reds are bad. And anything in between, it just depends what it is. So if it's like a yellow, it's close to the green, so it's not so bad. It's pretty decent. But if you're getting like an orange, it's close to really bad, but not so bad. Okay, and that's how they do their little color scale. Think of like a traffic light, red and green, right? Okay, so just for the record, you'll notice that a lot of the top listings, when you first sign into the entrepreneur plan, will be a lot of A's. Okay, a lot of A's and B's. There's a reason why. It's because it uploads all your products that were most recent. So usually the most recent products are the ones that got sold recently. And if they got sold recently, there's a good chance there's something good going on with it. Not everything, of course, but usually having it renewed recently helps your score. We'll talk more about that in a second. But if you go down, you'll easily notice you'll see a lot more B's and C's or whatever. Your shot may look different than mine. You might have a lot more B's, C's, and D's. Okay, maybe some even some F's. As you get lower and lower, you might see it get worse and worse. Only because, again, recency helps your relevancy score, and this is exactly that, okay? So what I like to do for myself, and I want you to do this as well, when you first log in and see this, there's a few different ways you could use it. The first way is saying, okay, which listings need help? Well, obviously the ones all the way toward the bottom probably need the most help, okay? So this is a really good to do it this way. You could scroll down all the way to the bottom, okay, and say, okay, these are my stepchildren, right? They're the ones that are not performing as well. So you could easily go to your C listings first and attack them, and I'll show you how to do that in just a second, and then the B's, and then so on, as you work your way up. Now, just for the record, these will change positions as you sell items in your shop. If you're a very active shop, such as myself, these will change positions. So whatever's on the bottom may not be in the bottom tomorrow. For example, this may sell tomorrow, and it may bump up a little bit, okay? So it's not always what's toward the bottom. It's really the scores you're trying to look for. But usually the worst scores are on the bottom. So now that you've identified which one you want to change, you go in the listing. Let me show you how to do that. Okay, let's get this show you what makes up the C-plus score. Okay, so you'll see these are things that make it up right over here. And of course, you'll see everywhere in the entrepreneurial plan these colors, or, you know, these colors, and it pretty much tells you if you're in the green or if you're in the red. Again, red and orange, not so great. Yellow and greenish are pretty good, right? So when you see red, you're like, uh-oh, what's wrong with this? So let's walk you through each one.
Okay, what I wanted to watch.
Obviously, the more photos, the better. It's probably a really...
Hi there, guys. This is Jenny from Fuzzy and Birch, and I am here to show you how I use... Thank you.
Tag, those tips were incredible, and we can all, including myself, put those tips to use for our YouTube channels and YouTube videos. And Peg and I actually teamed up and created a Pinterest board together of all of my YouTube tutorials, and I'll put the link below so you can check it out. And if you want to make sure that your YouTube channel is actually set up for success, I put a link below to the Boss YouTube channel checklist to make sure that you don't miss any steps in getting your channel set up the right way to attract your ideal customers and to build your brand. Make sure you download that below this video. If you like this video, hit the like button below, share it with your friends, and be sure to subscribe. And I'll see you guys next week. Thanks for watching. Bosses, it's Sunny Leonard Doozy, and today I am sharing my top 5 tips for YouTube channel, and I have to say a big, huge thank you to you. Yes, you, because you have been an incredibly vital part of growing this community and growing this channel as fast as it's grown over the last 12 months and a bit. And I'm so thrilled to share and humbled to share that on Forbes.com last week, I was named to the 20 must-watch channels that will change your business. Calm down. It's fine. Crazy. Huge honor. I really can't believe it, and I'm in some amazing company, and I'm going to just link those channels below this video as well because they're great examples of what you can do on YouTube. But today, I wanted to give back and share my experience of growing my channel. And keep in mind, if you're sitting there thinking, easy for you to say, you've got 50,000 subscribers, which, by the way, we just surpassed that milestone, so again, thank you. But here's the thing, exactly a year ago today, I had less than 5,000 subscribers. I had just basically gotten started on YouTube, and I started from scratch. I had basically no subscribers when I started, really no videos on my channel, and I taught myself everything. So I'm going to share with you in this video my keys to growing a successful YouTube channel, because if I can do it, and if I can get 50,000 subscribers in a year, you can too. So let's get started. Tip number one is set your intention. And this might seem very counterintuitive, but don't focus on subscriber growth. Focus on the quality of your community, the comments on your videos, and also your views. That's what matters most, because we want to make sure that your content is actually getting traction. And the only way that you're going to gain traction on YouTube is if you have a clear intent when you start making videos and a clear objective moving forward. So what are you doing this for? If it's just for fun and you're not taking it seriously, no one else will. I kind of fell into this backwards because I started making YouTube videos to answer client questions because I was getting the same ones over and over again. I didn't actually start with the intent of growing my channel to where it is today, but I realized there was a need for it. So my intent when I started was to help people and to teach people and to educate. That was my intent, and that's what I've stuck to the entire time with all of my content. So get really clear on your objective. And also, if your intent is to start making videos on YouTube to make money, don't do it. Because you don't make money making videos on YouTube, but if you do, it's going to take a few years, usually, to get there. If you want to do it the sponsorship route and you want to have people pay for your videos and that kind of stuff, you sponsor your videos and give you gadgets and all those things, that doesn't happen until you have some serious growth behind you. So set your intent, get really clear on why you're doing what you're doing, and take it seriously. Still have fun, but take it seriously. And on that note, if your intent is to grow your business using YouTube, amazing, because it's one of the best tools out there to do that. But if that is your intent, you have to figure out how to get your traffic off of YouTube onto whatever your conversion site is. So whether that's growing your email list, which is how I've grown my list to thousands upon thousands of people strictly using YouTube, or driving people to your website, your e-commerce site, whatever your business conversion site is, make sure that you're taking all this traffic that you're earning off of YouTube and sending them to your business, to your conversion site, online, or maybe even offline, kind of have people contact you offline. Tip number two is build your community from scratch. I know that sounds daunting and difficult, but here is the best thing that I did when I started on YouTube. I found like-minded YouTubers with similar audiences to me, covering similar content to me, and I would go in and I would engage with them. I would engage with their community in the comments section. I would answer any questions if their community had questions that weren't getting answered. I would be there to help and to serve and to support. I wasn't there to promo my channel or promo my videos. I was strictly there to help and support and be a part of that community and be seen by people who were interested in my kind of content and then hopefully bring them over to my channel. But that drove so much growth at the beginning. And here's another little bonus tip. You also want to make sure that you're following these people with similar audiences to you on other social media platforms. So engage with them on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, and start building a relationship with them, and then eventually you can collaborate with them and cross-promote each other's channels. But building that community right from the start, the simplest way to do it is find people with similar audiences to you who share similar content to you and be engaged in the community, both on YouTube first and then on all the other social platforms as well. And then the other thing about building a community from scratch is asking questions. People will do what you ask them to do. So whether you think it's annoying or not, from day one on all of my videos, I've always said at the end, if you like this video, hit the like button below, share it with your friends, and be sure to subscribe at the end of my videos, and people do it. It has to be good content, but people will take action if you say those words. Tip number three is consistency. I talk about this a lot, and I know a few of you are sitting there thinking, ugh, that really doesn't work. Sorry, but it is work. There is no magic formula here, and the more consistent you are, the more that you build trust with your community, and they know you're going to be back every single week. So try and post on a regular schedule. If you can't do it every week, do it once a month. Set a day once a month that you're going to post. Just try and be consistent in your posting schedule, because that's going to keep people coming back, sharing your content with their audiences, growing your reach week over week. So try, again, to stay consistent with your schedule, but also stay consistent with your content. So try and focus on one niche. If I have one tip for you that's going to grow your channel extremely fast, focus on your niche. What is this specific area that you want to talk about, that your genius zone is in? Focus on that. Answer every single question related to that niche in your...
Crappy drawing of a pink bird thing? Ask your niece. Go to Fiverr and get a professionally designed logo for brand recognition. Any style, any budget. Created just for you. Get yours on Fiverr.com today.
After I'd been in business for about a year, I decided that I wanted to launch a product. I read all of these stories online about people who were having 5, 6, even 7 figure launches, and it sounded pretty cool, and it also sounded like there wasn't that much to it. Seems like they just put together a great product, and then they advertised it on social media, they advertised it to their email list, and then people bought it in droves. And that sounded really neat. It sounded like a great way to make some extra money in my business. At that time, I was working really hard for every single sale that I made, every single new customer that I got, and I thought that it sounded wonderful to have this big injection of cash inside. So, accordingly, I built a course. It was fairly expensive. It took me several weeks to complete, and it is a really good course, and I actually still sell it now today because it was a great course that I put together. But I then tried to launch it, and I also put a lot of time into that launch. You can probably guess where the story is going. I sold exactly 0 of that course. I thought, midway through the launch, I thought that I had sold one. I think it was on the second day of my week-long open car. I thought I had sold one copy of the course, and I was very excited. And then I discovered that the person had only registered for the course, but hadn't actually bought it. So they just, like, signed up to buy it. They entered in a username and a password, but then they hadn't actually proceeded to buy it. So I was very disappointed. So we get to the end of the week, and I had sold absolutely 0 copies of my course. And I was frustrated, but also confused. I wasn't hugely let down because I had no idea what was going to happen. I thought maybe I would sell lots of them, maybe I would sell none of them. It was an experiment, but I was frustrated because I didn't know what I had done wrong, and I didn't know what I could do differently in the future. It wasn't like, oh, I sold 10 copies of my course, what can I do a little bit better to sell 11 copies? It was a complete failure. And so I then spent the next about 1 year trying to figure out exactly what I did wrong and what I could do differently so that I could actually successfully launch a product in the future. And it took me about a whole year to figure that out. But what I finally realized and what allowed me to then have a successful launch of my next product is that there was a couple of key components that are absolutely essential for having a successful launch, and I had basically missed all of them. So obviously, I mean, there's some things that everyone knows about launching. You have to have a product, or at least have a plan for a product. You might be selling your product live, like a live training program or something like that, and that's fine. But you do have to have some sort of product, and you have to have people to buy it. Now that is a given, and I did think of those 2 things initially, but I did think about how I was going to actually connect those things, or how I was going to get people to actually know about my course and buy it. So there's
advertise my course to people who might be interested and do that effectively and also affordably? Because you might be able to target exactly the right person, but if it costs you $1,000 to reach that one person, obviously that is a no-go as far as advertising goes. If you could reach them for a penny, that would be awesome, right? But you need to be able to advertise in some sort of effective way that allows you to more than break even so that you can make a profit. So maybe you're selling your product for $100, so you need to be able to advertise in a way that acquires a customer somewhere less than $100. Maybe it's $50 to acquire a customer, $75 to acquire a customer. And obviously your leads are going to be even cheaper than that. But so you need access to some sort of affordable, effective advertising. Now the second thing that is essential for an effective, now the second thing that is essential for a successful launch is the ability to actually attract those people who you advertise to and make them interested in your product. So you could plaster signs for your course, your program, or your service on every billboard in your city, but if your billboard is ugly, or you're reaching the wrong people, or it doesn't tell them what your course is actually about, then obviously it doesn't matter how cheap that advertising is, you're not really enticing the people to buy your course. Now the third very important part is that you have to be able to convert your interested people into actual buyers. So somehow you have to bridge that gap between they are interested in buying your product and they actually buy your product. So you have to somehow convince them to buy, and you have to make the sales process as simple as possible so that they don't get frustrated along the way and give up. And then the fourth thing is the ability to maximize the average cart value. So basically what that means is that whenever someone is buying your product, they might buy some small amount, like they might buy one bottle of something, or they might buy your smallest package or your simple course, or they might buy more. They might buy two bottles of your product, or they might buy your most premier package, or they might buy your course plus some bonuses. So if you are only getting that barest minimum of the cart value, so like if your course sells for $100, if you're only getting $100 for each successful course sale, then you have to keep your advertising costs really low. But if you have a bonus where someone can also get some additional coaching sessions with you or an additional workbook or something like that that can make some people spend more money, then the average amount of money that people spend will be a little bit higher and you are able to spend more money on your advertising, which means you're able to reach more people. So those are the four components of a successful launch, and let me just run down how I managed to achieve each of them so that I was able to have a successful launch after several failed launch attempts that resulted in zero profit. So with my failed launches, my methods of advertising were basically free social media to try to attract people to my website. So I was just basically spamming Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. I was trying to be helpful also to make people want to come join me, but I mean, essentially what I was doing was I was trying to use it as a free advertising platform to attract people back to my website. So that was what was not working. What did end up working was actually paying for real advertising, like a real business. So I started making Facebook ads that were dragging people back to my website to be interested in my content, which leads us into step two. They became interested in my blog posts, which I was specifically writing to interest people in the topics of my course and to kind of subtly sell the ideas that were in my course. So rather than just pitching my course cold to an audience who had never even thought of the ideas that were in the course and thought, oh, I need those ideas, instead I started a post that explained why this was such a great thing, why they needed this topic in their life, why they needed to learn more about it, what it could do for their life. And you might think that this would be a sort of blog post that no one would want to read, but I mean, think of all the articles that you've read about why skincare is so important or why an email list is important. People read articles like that all the time. So I was writing compelling articles of that nature explaining why the topic of my course was an important thing that they needed for their business. And then once they came to my blog and read those articles, then I was getting them to sign up for my newsletter, and I was then able to use my newsletter to effectively convert them into buyers. And then for the fourth and final step of these four essential components, I was able to raise my average cart value by making multiple different packages for my course. So instead of just having that basic level for my course, I added on two additional levels, one which had a group coaching option and also a couple bonuses, and one that had a one-on-one coaching option,
difference between my failed launch attempts and my successful launch attempts. When I ended up failing so much, it was because I wasn't really advertising effectively at all. I was unwilling to invest in my business and spend the money that I needed to get the word out there about my course. So effectively, no one had even heard about it. Second of all, I was basically pitching my course cold because I wasn't doing any of this educational content that my audience is reading and consuming so that they knew why they needed my course. I just suddenly was like, here's 10 reasons why you need my course in an email. And it was too much too soon when I hadn't warmed them up properly. And so that also ties into the third problem that I was having, which is I wasn't able to convert them into buyers. And that's just because I hadn't warmed them up at all. And then finally, my average cart value would have been really low. I mean, it was zero because I couldn't have anyone buy. But even if someone had bought, it would have been very low. I only had the one simple package and I didn't have any upsells. So I hope that that shows you the difference between what I did right that resulted in a five-figure launch versus what I did wrong that resulted in absolutely zero sales. Have you ever tried to launch a course or a different product? Launches are such an amazing strategy for selling more of anything. All those stories of five and six and seven-figure launches, I don't know if they're all true, you know, I don't know if people can tell these stories. And I think that some of them definitely are true and others probably are not. But really what it comes down to is that having a sale does make people more inclined to buy. You know, if Nordstrom is having a sale, then you're more likely to go to Nordstrom and buy stuff that maybe you did or maybe you didn't need. And a launch is effectively just that. It's a special sale and it can be something to promote, it can send, it's exciting, and it gives people a motivation to buy because there's a limited window of opportunity. They think, oh, this is the only time I can get that course all year, or this is the only time I can get this service for 40% off, or whatever it might be. You're giving people a reason to take action now, which is really essential for making more sales. If you have a service-based online business or you're a course creator, then I would love it if you left me a comment down below to tell me a little bit about what you are selling or what you'd like to sell, and if you've ever thought about using a launch to sell more of it. Also, if you found this helpful or interesting, then please give it a thumbs up to let me know that you liked it and also to help more people find it in the future. And I'd love it if you subscribe to my channel so that you can be with me for my future videos. I publish 2 videos every single week on topics of my entrepreneurial lifestyle and marketing strategy. Thank you so much for watching, and I look forward to seeing you in my next one. This October, join me in a motivated group of 1,000 entrepreneurs for the much-anticipated Ready, Set, Launch Challenge. This is a 3-4-day challenge that will help you plan out your most successful, most profitable launch ever. To sign up for the challenge, just visit gillianperkins.com/ready-set-launch. As you can see here in the bar, you'll be taken to this page where you'll see exactly how many days, hours, and minutes are left before the challenge kicks off. And then you'll click Take the Challenge and enter your information. It's completely free and it will guide you through the process. During the challenge, you will get exclusive free access to some of my video trainings that are normally reserved for paying customers. You'll also get daily PDF assignments and access to the challenge Facebook group where you'll be able to post your answers to the daily challenge questions for your chance to win some awesome prizes. I hope you take the plunge and join us for this year's challenge.